And here is a look at the course, and it starts at the famous Sambadrome, and then we'll turn onto Avenue President Vargas, and then they will do three 10-kilometre laps around the port area down by the water and make their way back to the Sambadrome eventually. But it's not the hilliest course. The women went 2:24.04 for their marathon. The quickest time of the year was 2:19.41 in 2016. So what we saw was a time that was around about 5 minutes outside of that. But part of that was to do with those weather conditions you were talking about, because it was pretty warm and there was a high attrition rate in the women's marathon a week ago.
Yeah, if you look at Sungong's personal best, she's a high 2:20 performer, and she won in 2:24.02. It is sometimes hard to compare different courses, but yes, I think at the very least we're talking about a time probably 3, maybe even 4 to 5 minutes slower than the fastest time in the world, which is set by the man who is in this field and is on paper the favorite for the gold medal, Eliud Kipchoge, the Kenyan who is a two-time Olympic medalist over the 5,000 metres. Great success early on in his career, but he's arguably enjoyed his best days of all on the roads of the big city marathons, and he came within a whisker of beating Dennis Kimeto's world record in London earlier this year in April. I was there to watch that race, and in fact, sometimes in the major championship marathons, you don't have the quickest men in the world, but the four fastest in 2016 are all here. Two Kenyans, two Ethiopians. So we're all teed up for a great battle here. Now the rain is coming down pretty hard. It was just a bit of a trickle when we left the hotel very early this morning, but that's a proper downpour. The Brazilians don't look too happy. I don't think they're as used to the rain as we are back home in Britain.
Quite possibly not. And here is the start list, and it's going to take quite a while to get through these, because we do have in excess of 150 athletes. And the Ethiopians and the Kenyans obviously will be some of the people who attract the attention. 31-year-old Eliud Kipchoge, we've spoken about. He's run 7 marathons, he's won 6 of them, and his time in London was 2:03.05. The defending champion is the 27-year-old Ugandan Stephen Kiprotich, who ran 2:08.01 in London when he won. He was also the 2013 world champion and 6th in 2015. Solomon Mutai was 3rd in the world championships. Gurmay Gebrselassie is the world champion, so it's a field full of quality, and as usual, we'd expect the African nations to be up the front of the field, and up the front of the field reasonably quickly.
Yes, I don't think they'll be hanging around in this race, but there's some interesting history on the line here, because only 2 men have successfully defended the Olympic title. The legendary Habiba Bekele, who became the first black African Olympic champion, and to say that he sparked a generation of stars would be an understatement, famously kicking off his shoes in Rome, and then when he defended the title in Tokyo 4 years later, he came into the stadium so far ahead of everyone else, he was doing warm down exercises before the second place athlete had even entered the arena. And then the second man to defend the title, Vladimir Tsiapinski, who won in Montreal and Moscow and even managed to get a bronze in the inaugural World Champs in Helsinki in 83. And you can't rule Stephen Kiprotich out. Some people felt that the performance he produced in London 4 years ago was a little bit of a one-off, because he's not the type of guy who's in the mix when a big city marathon's being won in high 203s and low 204s. But he absolutely proved that he's up to the task, because in 2013 in Moscow, in baking conditions, he became only the second man in history to take the world title and hold the world and Olympic crowns both at exactly the same time. So Stephen Kiprotich might not be the quickest in the field, and he may not feature at the front right at the beginning if the pace is fairly hot, but he's got a really good record come the major championships, and wasn't too far away from the mix-up in Beijing last year. And then the other little bit of history that may be made today, Gurmay Gebrselassie, the Eritrean, you may think he's an Ethiopian with that name, winning the world title last year, but still barely out of his teenage years. He's hoping to produce Eritrea's first ever Olympic gold medal. The only medal the Eritreans have ever won in the Olympics was when the legendary cross-country runner and multiple world half marathon champion Zerzanay Tadese got a bronze behind Kenenisa Bekele in the 10,000 metres in Athens. So there are loads of subplots going on here. There is history at stake for all of them as the clock ticks down to the start of the final event in the 2016 athletics program, and it's going to be grueling and it's going to be dramatic.
And it's just as well we started our coverage early to get through that start list. In London 4 years ago, we had 105 competitors. There's Galen Rupp, interesting that he's going up to the marathon distance. And he's a highly talented athlete, was involved in that incident with Mo Farah, of course, in the 10,000 metres, where Mo Farah actually fell, and he fell across the heels of Galen Rupp, who went back and made sure that his friend and compatriot was okay. And there is the man that we were talking about, Gurmay Gebrselassie from Eritrea, the reigning world champion. There are 155 entries in this race from 80 different countries compared to the 105 that started in London 4 years ago.
Stanley Biewott just on the rider picture. There's Lemmy Bahanu. He won Boston this year, 204.33, second in Dubai. But Stanley Biewott, second in that legendary race against his compatriot Eliud Kipchoge in London, becoming the sixth fastest in history with 203.51. And there's the favourite. He's a veteran these days. He became the world champion over 5,000 metres as an 18-year-old way back in Paris in 2003. But my goodness me, has he enjoyed an incredible transformation to the roads for the marathon. And what about this fella, 39 years of age, his very last marathon. Talk about bowing out in style. Here we go then, the clock ticking down. Such a long way, such a great story is about to unfold, it always is.
42.195 kilometres. 26 miles, 385 yards. It is one of the great adventures of the Olympic Games each and every year. And despite the fact that all of the timing devices exist along the road, the runners do things the way they always do and start their own watches. They're about to start their engines on a very soggy day in Rio de Janeiro for the Olympic marathon. Will it be the defending champion, Stephen Kiprotich, or will the favorite, Eliud Kipchoge, reign? We're about to find out. The adventure begins in Rio. 155 runners from 80 different nations embarking on the most grueling athletic event of them all. And Galen Rupp will find himself up the front early, and he'll have plenty of company from the Ethiopians and the runners of the African nations. Great sight here at the Samba Dome. For those of you who don't know, the area the Samba Dome is famous. It is a permanent structure there, and it is there for carnival. So it's a very different feeling what these athletes are feeling to what the people who normally come down this avenue are feeling.
Yeah, so hopefully there'll be a few more of them if the rain eases off towards the back end of the race. There'll be a few more people to greet them coming back into the stadium. Fascinating to see how the American Galen Rupp goes. He's right in the center of your picture, one of the tallest in the field, competing in the 10,000 meters alongside his great friend and rival Mo Farah. He was unable to replicate the silver that he produced behind Mo in 2012, but he did drop back in the race with a really great sporting gesture. We're talking about Rupp. He's just behind Gebrselassie there, the reigning world champion, the Eritrean. Rupp dropped back to see whether Mo was okay, because it was actually Rupp's heels that Farah tripped on, and Galen Rupp wasn't sure how he would go in the American trials, which was undertaken in scorching conditions in LA back in February, early February. But he won those trials in 2:11 plus change and finds himself here the only man in this 155 field who has already competed in 2016. You might think that's a bit strange, but actually a sharp six and a bit miler, which is what the 10,000 meters is, and then a very, very easy week of light jogging, and these guys are fit enough that hopefully there shouldn't be too much fatigue in his legs, as long as he has had a nice easy week. And I hope he was in the stadium last night, or maybe he wasn't, given that he's competing this morning. I'm sure he was watching back in the athletes' village to see Mo doing the double double and replicating the legendary exploits of Lassie Viren from 72 and 76. So Galen Rupp having his turn here to try and produce a golden moment. And well, it would be a fantastic achievement, but a very, very, very long way to go, and I'm not sure we'll see too many athletes trying to go too hard too early here. They'll be quite happy to sit and let the miles tick along in the early stages.
They're on Avenue Presidente Vargas, which is one of the busiest roads right through the centre of Rio de Janeiro, and they will come to a very busy intersection in just a few kilometres' time, the intersection of Avenue Presidente Vargas and Avenue Rio Branco. We know for a fact that it is a very busy intersection because our hotel is right there, and it doesn't matter what time of the day or night it is, there are thousands of people around that particular intersection. When we got back to the hotel after the athletics last night, it was like it was rush hour, and it was midnight, 1 o'clock in the morning.
It's a city that never really goes to sleep. I know that's the famous headline about New York. Well, there are certainly areas around Rio de Janeiro, including the famous library. I'm not sure there's too many parties going on there at midnight or one in the morning, but certainly this road where the athletes are jogging by their own mercurial standards, very busy, and it has been a great atmosphere. The stadiums may not have been full as they were in London 4 years ago, but that's an unfair comparison because London really was the exception rather than the rule. But when the Brazilians have turned out, they really have created a fantastic atmosphere, and already we can see the splits, and that's quite sensible because any of you who've run a marathon, even if you've jogged around in 4 hours or you've been trying to break 3.5 or break that club runner's barrier of 3 hours, you have got to run at your own pace, especially in the very, very early stages.
Just to identify the man in white on the left of your picture, 29:47, that's Tedesse Abraham of Switzerland, 34 years of age, formerly from Eritrea. He won the half marathon at the European Championships this year, and he's got a lifetime best time of 2:06:40 for the marathon, which he set this year.
And already spreading out. But this is why the Olympic marathon is so interesting, because, I mean, OK, the performance of the late Sami Wanjiru in 2008 was amazing, winning in 2:06.5. But more often than not, these races are not very quick. We've only had 4 Olympic marathons where the winning time has been inside 2:10. And that will certainly help the likes of Galen Rupp, because he hasn't broken 2:11 yet. He's only done one marathon. The times are largely irrelevant when it comes to the major championship. And that is why so often the Olympic marathon produces an unusual story, someone who wasn't expected to be in the mix.
We just saw a shot of the runner's shoes, and we saw one before the start of the race, and you saw an object on their shoes. That is actually a transponder, and that is how the athletes are timed. They all wear individual transponders, and they will go over mats and timing equipment at 5 kilometer splits along the way, so we have the most accurate and up-to-date timing possible.
The technology these days is absolutely brilliant. I remember running my first couple of marathons, and you'd have to wait until you read your name in the newspaper. If you run the London Marathon, you can buy the Times, a special pullout. You can say my name was in the Times. It's kind of exciting if you're a bit of a running anorak. But you'd have to look down the list at roughly what you thought your time was to look for your name to get your official time. Now, even club runners and fun runners with that transponder, you will have your official time by the time you've had your first cup of tea or your first pint or whatever it is when you finish the marathon. It's amazing how quickly the information comes through to you.
And the runners now coming up towards the intersection with Avenue Rio Branco. They're not far away. That beautiful old church, Candelaria Church, is just across the way from our hotel. That's where we pull up in the bus every night. It's such a beautiful sight, a wonderful part of the city. And just before they get there, they will turn right onto Avenue Rio Branco. They're going past an area where the tube station, if you're in London, you'd call it the tube station, the underground here, the metro. There's a lot of markets on the right-hand side, which are normally bustling. They might be a bit later on in the day, but of course, with all of the roads blocked off, the spectators getting there to say good luck to the runners as they embark on their journey before they do the right turn, and then they'll be back in a couple of hours' time.
Oh, it looks like we're going to be getting some great arty images here. Your body really does take a pounding when you run a marathon. That's why even these guys who are at the very peak of their physical powers would certainly not contemplate running. Well, you get the occasional guy who will run 10 or 12 in a year, but at the standard these guys are running at, it would be very unusual for them to run more than three, maybe one if you're going to do very early January, mid-spring, but usually you'd go for spring and then you'd go for autumn, which is why those two seasons are so popular for the big city marathons. You've got New York in the likes of November, and then London and Rotterdam in April, Berlin at the end of September, where so many great world records have been set. Haile Gebrselassie became the first man in history under 2:04 in Berlin a few years ago. And as we are just coming up to the hotel we're staying at, we were having a little bet with our field event commentator, who promised he'd get up at the crack of dawn and we'd see him by the side of the course.
I thought I saw him there with his wet weather gear on, John Trower.
Yeah, so maybe.
He has on it. Well, maybe he just stuck his head out his hotel window and looked at the field going past. That was a good way to do it. I had the pleasure of doing that for the women's marathon the other day.
He promised us he'd get up.
Yeah. Well, he's promised lots of things. So just a little separation from that group, and they're running their own race at the moment, but it won't be too difficult for them to latch onto the back. But you don't want to get those gaps appearing early in the race of 15, 20 metres or so, because that can be a worrying sign early. It's always better, as these 25 or 30 runners are doing, and we see Stephen Kiprotich up there in the yellow of Uganda, the 27-year-old, the defending champion, sixth in the World Championships last year, World Champion of 2013. As they go through the first 3 kilometres, so only a mere 39 kilometres to go.
It's an exhilarating distance, but it can be heartbreaking if the wheels come off and you get it wrong. But what a story it would be for Eliud Kipchoge. You can tell the track background. I'm talking about Kipchoge. You've got Wesley Kuria, the second of the two Kenyans. They're both running in the middle of the field there. Kipchoge just slightly on the left. He's got that lovely economical track action. World champion in 2003, twice an Olympic medalist, picking up a bronze and a silver. And what a story it would be if his glorious golden moment was to come on the roads. And it was after he failed to qualify for the Olympic 5 or 10,000 metre team for Kenya in London that he decided to change angle. And I remember a press conference. He did the World Half Marathon Championships in Kavana in Bulgaria in about the October of 2012, a boiling hot day. And he did the press conference there and he said, I'm going to have a crack at the marathon and I've just got a funny feeling that I might be really, really good at it, which may sound a little boastful, but many Kenyans are not like that. And you got the impression that he really meant it. And my goodness me, has he gone on to prove that. He's run 7 marathons, won 6 of them. His slowest marathon, Eliud Kipchoge, is 2:05:30, and that was his first marathon in Hamburg. He's got an absolutely incredible record. So in theory, he should be the overwhelming favourite here, but history tells us that favourites very rarely win the Olympic marathon. So a lot of intrigue to come over the next hour and 50 minutes or so.
The man from China who is up at the head of the field, Zhu Renxu, is 25 years of age. He's a 2:18 runner, so he wouldn't be expected to trouble Lees, but he'll get himself a little bit of television time, which is always important. Runners need to be careful in this section of the circuit. We just saw that they're running through areas where there were trees and posts, and I just need to keep their wits about them here because the field is still comparatively compacted after nearly 12 minutes of running and nearly 4 kilometres of running. As we look at the Chinese up near the head of the field along with the Swiss, and they'll make a few little twists and turns, and it's not long now before they'll get themselves on the first of the 3 10-kilometre loops, which will take them around by the bay and the port area.
I just noticed Abraham running beside El Hissouf. He just put his arm out just to indicate that they were coming up to a sharp corner. We've had an unusual number of fallers on the track during the last 8 days. What a great 8 days it was as well. So really important for these guys when they're running so tightly bunched, and so many of them still together. It's not easy for those buried in the heart of the pack to be able to see the sharp turns, so the athletes looking out for themselves as much as they are looking out for each other. So just about half a mile away from the 5K checkpoint, which will give us our first split. And another one of these fabulous close-up super slow-mos. It all looks very calm and within the boundaries here. There's one of those sharp corners we were talking about, but yeah. they won't be looking that serene when there's 20 minutes to go and the wheels are beginning to come off for one or two of them. El Hissouf there just pointing out that there's a pothole in the road to Kiprop, the Ugandan, so that's nice to see a sporting gesture.
We often talk about the camaraderie that exists between the decathletes because they know the pain that they go through and they can identify with their fellow athletes. Just getting on a bit of a downhill stretch here, so the pace increasing a little. And there is a similar camaraderie, a similar fellowship amongst the marathon runners. They'll always look out for each other. Yes, they're trying to beat each other. That's what they're out there for. But when it comes to little things like that, they'll always be mindful of the other athletes around them and the safety of the athletes. They don't want to see anyone hitting the deck out there on a day like this. And it's possible. It's even though it is raining, it's not going to be terribly slippery around the roads. But the athletes will just be taking due care and attention to look after their fellow runners as well.
Ah, there's a huge amount of mutual respect here because, make no mistake, even the athletes who are coming out the back of this big group, and athletes who take 2.5 hours, and there'll be one or two who take 2.75 hours, every single one of the men proudly representing their nation here in the world's most important marathon, they have put in the yards. They've done hundreds of miles a week, out for a run in the morning, just a cup of tea, maybe 8, 9, 10 miles, then a sleep, a bit of breakfast, some speed work, and some will even go for a third run in the day. So they can't fail to know the hard work that they've all and each put in just to be on this start line.
The man on the left in the green from Burundi is Abraham Niankuru. He's 26 years of age. He's a 2:16 runner, so you wouldn't expect that he would be up there. But then again, as we've said before, it's not necessarily the men who've got the fastest times on paper. It's not necessarily the favourites for the race who will get it done. The Olympic marathon nearly always produces at least one surprise. So they go through 5 kilometres in 15:31.
Yeah, pretty steady. That's quite a nice pace, really. Just outside, what's that? That's an inside 2:11 pace. So that's what you'd expect in the early stages. Nothing too crazy. But what's really interesting about this race, we are correct in saying that it's very rarely the fastest man on paper who wins the race. But the reason I still think Eliud Kipchoge is the favourite for this gold medal, and there he is, he's just running behind Bekele, the expatriated Ethiopian. They call him Mini Kenenisa, mainly because of his name rather than his running action or his visual resemblance to the multiple Olympic champion over 10,000 metres. And we'll come on to the controversy of Bekele not being selected for the Ethiopians in a moment. But the reason I still have Kipchoge down as the favourite, it's not because he's the fastest in the field on paper, it's because he's run 7 marathons since he made the conversion from the track. And he has produced a really, really good performance in every single one of those races. He's had a consistency that matches the speed he's produced. So for that reason, I still put him down as favourite. But if he had run 2:03:05, and that was the only performance we'd seen from him in the last 2 years, I wouldn't put him down as favourite. But when you pair up the consistency with the speed, that's an irresistible combination. And he's got a great, great chance to finally become an Olympic champion, having picked up silvers and bronze on the track back in Athens and Beijing.
There was just a little bit of organisation from the Chinese runners there, getting themselves up near the front of the race. So they've got a couple up there. Alima Bekele, we were speaking about, 26 years of age. His personal best set this year at 2:13:28, formerly from Ethiopia, has Rob mentioned. 2013 Asian champion at 10,000 metres. So just a little splintering at various sections of the field. And it won't take long for some of the runners to get away from the lead pack. And then it will be a long way home for them. A couple of the South Africans there. What a games it's been for them. Of course, in the athletics program on the track with Wade van Niekerk running that world record. And then last night, Caster Semenya with a dominant performance in the 800 metres to take the gold medal. So they would have been inspired seeing athletes from their home nation, despite the fact they run at a very different distance, but to see their nation's colours up there on the top step of the victory days is always something that inspires athletes of a particular nation.
Great performances from both Van Niekerk and Caster Semenya. Van Niekerk, I think, carried the flag into the stadium. That was one of the races of the games. All three men coming home inside 44 seconds. And LeSean Merritt finally got his gold after finishing third in that race, anchoring the Americans to the final gold of the track and field program. But this is the last one. What a nice moment it is. We were saying the other day when we were coming back from the track, a lovely tradition of the men's marathon. There surely cannot be a finer place to be awarded and presented your gold medal than during the closing ceremony. It was absolutely sensational when Stephen Kiprotich became only the second Ugandan Olympic champion between since John Akebui won the four hurdles in Munich in 72. When Kiprotich was presented with his gold medal in the stadium in London 4 years ago, there was a tiny contingent of Ugandan athletes going absolutely berserk on the floor beneath him. And that's the prize that awaits them. It's not only the Olympic gold, it's not only a place in history, but your medal is presented to you in front of the entire stadium, in front of the entire world.
And as we have a look at these athletes, a concentration in slow motion, Daniele Maiucci of Italy has made his way up to the front of the race, and he has now taken it up. Eighth of the World Championships, 30 years of age, and third in the European Championship half marathon, so he'll be nippy, and there he is over on the left-hand side of your picture. The gap that is starting to form now between the first 30 or so runners, and if you can count them that quickly, you're better than me, but that gap is just a little bit of a worry for those athletes, including Michael Shelley of Australia, who's back there, and also the other Australian in Liam Adams, is also in that pack. They don't want that gap to get too much bigger than that, even though it's only 6.5 kilometres into the race.
Yes, but they have to run their own race. If they're not feeling comfortable, even if it's only a fraction of a drop back, then they just need to take their time. There's a long way to go. The old adage in the marathon, which sounds silly, but when you've run a marathon, you know how true this is. In terms of how your body feels, when you get to 20 miles, that is halfway. That is how much the last 6 miles can take out of your body when you're running a marathon. You have got to make sure that there's something still left in the tank over the last 6 miles. And even in this race, these guys are unbelievably fit. But it will all change, or could all change, in those last 3 or 4 miles as one or two find out that they haven't quite saved enough for the climax, and they might drift heart-achingly away from a medal when they've worked so hard to put themselves in pole position. But three distinct groups there, and two athletes isolated between the two motorbikes. One of them is one of the Hawkins brothers. We have Callum and Derek Hawkins representing Great Britain, and he's in no man's land there between the two groups.
That's an awful place to be, because you don't know whether you drop back to the group behind and run comfortably there, or whether you expend the energy to make up that 15 metres as we come through a drink station here, which can often cause some issues. But whether you go back or whether you go forward, no man's land is the perfect way to describe it. It's a time when you need to make a decision.
Yeah, it's a tough place to be, and it can be on the track as well. You just can't make that gap up to the lead group ahead of you. It's really tough. That's where you're reliant on your own training and your own mental strength just to switch off a little bit and focus on your own cadence. But a couple of groups separating here. cool set, the Canadian, and then the cameras will track back. And here are the two guys in that no man's land. And in fact, it's two Britons running side by side. So we have the great story. I'm fairly sure that's the younger of the Hawkins brothers. So that's Callum. His brother Derek performed well at the Commonwealth Games recently. But the two Scots running together, and I say Scots because we have an expatriated Eritrean, Sege Tavalde, who was the second British finisher behind Callum Hawkins in the London Marathon, ran in the World Cross for Eritrea and decided to stay in Scotland, and he's been embraced by the Scottish distance running community. And here he is flying the flag for Great Britain, but he and Callum trying to close the gap on that lead group. They were the two athletes just isolated off the back, a few seconds behind Kipchoge and all the rest.
One of the runners who's up near the lead is Tavalde Estefanos of Eritrea. He won an important marathon last year. Look at that. There's an example of what I was talking about with the Chinese. They've got themselves organized up the front of the race, and they've got all three of the runners, three maximum for each of the countries. Estefanos, 23:38 in the colours of Eritrea. Yes, he ran a marathon and got that important victory, 209.16. There's the man that most of the focus is on, Eliud Kipchoge, at 31 years of age, an incredible record with marathons. Having run seven, he's won all but one of them and recorded that brilliant time that we spoke about in London. 203.05. Not far away from the world record time of Dennis Kometo of Kenya, which was set in Berlin in 2014. It's only in recent times that we've actually had a recognised world record. It used to be classified as the world's best time for the marathon. And the reason for that was the variation of the courses, that you would have some courses that had a lot more downhill stretches than others. And so they used to talk about a world's best time rather than a world record. But now they've adopted that terminology, and Kometo has it. And Samuel Wanjiru has the Olympic record, 206.32. And that was set in Beijing 8 years ago.
And what a sad demise it was for one of the great. And he really was one of the great Kenyan athletes. I'm not just saying that because he's passed away, but if Sammy Wanjiru had lived and not died far too young, he may well now be the reigning world record holder, because there were some lightning quick times in his legs, a legendary win in Chicago. But it is interesting, the debate rages about whether and when or if a man will run under 2 hours for the marathon. I think it will happen, but it may well not be for another 25 years or so. But Eliud Kipchoge there, I was there watching that race in London, and he was having an epic battle with Stanley Biwott just on the right of your picture there. Biwott ran the sixth fastest time in history, came in under 2:04 for second place. I honestly think if Biwott hadn't been there, and Kipchoge, if he hadn't been preoccupied, first of all, with winning the race, if he'd been on his own, he may well have realised a little sooner that the world record was on. I don't think he was aware of just how fast they were running until it was too late to accelerate towards the line. So not only has he run seven marathons and won six of them, but for a few seconds, or realising 800 metres back down the road, he would probably be the reigning world record holder as well.
Already the field starting to string out. A couple of the men up near the front. Abdelmajid El Hissouf of Morocco is up at the front of the race. He's a 2:10.35 runner, one of four brothers. He's contested a couple of marathons, finished 10th in the Casablanca half marathon this year. And one of the other men who is up there at the front of the race is a much slower runner than he. 2:18.22 is the personal best for Hakim Sadi of Algeria. And he has not got a lot to recommend him. So you would think that he's up there on borrowed time at the front of the field. They just went through a little bit of an uphill stretch and now a little bit more downhill as they get down towards a very picturesque part of Rio de Janeiro. They're on the 10-kilometre loop. They will do this three times. And then by the time they get to the end of the third loop, it will be at the 35-kilometre mark. And that is when things will change in the race, and things can often change in your mind, because they talk about that wall that you can hit round about that mark. And when they get off this loop, that is the time when the wall all of a sudden might jump out and stop a few.
Yes, it doesn't matter how good you are going to go through a pain barrier in the marathon. That's Jared Ward. He was made the American team.
Well, looks pretty serene out there on Botafogo Bay this morning, despite the fact that it is an overcast and inclement morning. Some incredible pictures around the hills and mountains around Rio de Janeiro, and that is one thing that you notice when you come around this beautiful city. The amount of hills and mountains around the city, the geography of this place is something to behold. And of course, many of those hills and mountains are home to thousands of people in the favelas, as they're known in this part of the world. And they are neighborhoods where you need to keep your wits about you. They say if you can survive in the favelas in this part of the world, you can just about survive anywhere.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of the natural geography, you can see that the boldness of the landscape right behind the runners. Of all the places I've been to watch athletics around the world, it's arguably the most stunning in the way that the city just seems to rise and fall with the contours of the coastline. An absolutely stunning place, and it's been a great host venue for the Olympic Games. A lot has been made of the fact that the venues haven't been full, but we said this in the athletic stadium, and we weren't just saying it because we were here and we felt sorry for the Brazilians. Those who were there, yes, it hasn't been as busy as London, but those who were there made a huge amount of noise, and they really did create a carnival atmosphere in the stadium, even when it was half full or maybe two-thirds. The amount of noise that emanated from the 30 or 40,000 who were there was absolutely amazing.
And I'm sure you're the same as me, having been in the stadium on the night when Thiago Braz da Silva won the pole vault. That is a moment that I will carry with me for as long as I'm watching sport. That was incredible.
Amazing. You certainly didn't expect Renaud Lavillenie to lose the gold medal, having broken his own Olympic record. So that was da Silva's golden moment. Will today be Kipchoge's, after bronze in Athens and silver in Beijing? Well, if he does do it, there'll be memories of the late, great Alain Mimoun, the marathon runner who had so many famous duels with Emil Zatopek in London in 48 and Helsinki in 52 on the track, and he decided to go for one more games in Melbourne in 56 for one last chance to try and beat Zatopek. Zatopek, of course, won the marathon in 52 after doing that ridiculous treble, the 5:10 and the marathon. And Alain Mimoun, in his last race representing France, finally turned silver into gold on the streets of Melbourne, the crowning moment of a great career. And there would be some parallels with that from that story to Eliud Kipchoge's if, and it is a big if, Kipchoge is still in front here in 32.2 kilometres time.
So they make the hairpin turn, which will take them back along the next part of this 10-kilometer loop, and they go through 10 kilometers in 31.08, so that kilometer in 15.37, just a little bit slower than the first 5k.
Yeah, so it's still inside 2:11 pace, which, you know, is fine. One or two of these athletes, especially those with the slower PBs, will be operating towards the top end of their threshold. But certainly the likes of Eliud Kipchoge and Stanley Biwott, and the two Ethiopians who were first and second in Dubai, Sefe Abera and Lemi Bahanu, they will all be pretty comfortable at the pace being set at the moment. And it's probably just a case of ticking these miles off and just making sure that as much energy as possible is conserved for the second half of the race, when it does start to get a little bit tasty. Just a little glimpse there of the man representing Turkey, Kaan Özbilen, almost inevitably. He's just on the second rider picture there. He is Kenyan, third in Seoul this year, got a silver in the newly formed European half marathon race, which was part of the European Championship. So he can't be discounted, the former Kenyan, 2:06:10 in Seoul. But every man in that lead group will certainly feel as though they've got enough And as long as the pace stays at around about 2.11 or 2.10.30, all of the men in that group probably have got enough to live with the pace. But at some stage, not just yet, it was too early now, at some stage a break will come, and that's where the field will split quite quickly, you suspect.
And just looking at our timing system, we have 100 of the athletes, of the 155 that started, within a minute of the lead pack. And looking at the lead pack, there is a time given of 2 seconds. In fact, let's take it down to 3 seconds, and 32 runners within 3 seconds of the lead. So that's pretty much the number of the lead pack. Expect that to get a whole lot less reasonably soon. Galen Rupp up there looking very comfortable. He's such a stylish runner. And he runs so bravely. He's just the man that you like to watch running on the track. And he looks as though he's not feeling any effects just at the moment from his track campaign in that 10,000 metres. But of course, after just 10 kilometres, he's used to running that distance. It's going to be a little bit further down the road where we might see the effects of the campaign that he's already had.
But Rupp will fancy this because he ran 2.11 to win that trial race for the United States in February. And we know he's in good shape after running well in the 10,000 metres here, although he didn't get a medal. But this pace will be comfortable for him. And whilst you were talking about Rupp, I just noticed there's Kipritich and Mutai. Kipritich just disappearing off shot there. There he is, the defending Olympic champion. The Kenyans were sharing their drinks bottles with him. And look at Kipchoge there. He's talking to Stanley Biwott. We're talking about the two men in the Kenyan vests, both wearing the white caps, having a full-on conversation there, just chatting through the tactics and their plan for the next few miles. That tells you how comfortably these world-class men at the front of this pace are feeling at the moment. But how nice that they're all sharing the bottles. I mean, Kipritich is a very, very proud Ugandan, but he's moved to Kenya to do his training there. But sharing water bottles between the nations, and certainly Eliud Kipchoge and Stanley Biwott were having a chat there as if they were out to knock out 10 miles before going back to one of their houses for a barbecue lunch. Great to see that in the early stages of what is one of the biggest races of their lives.
Stelepan Rahatsu, we just saw, of Belarus, is one of the men who's dropped away from the lead pack. And here are the others who are now almost consigned to a race of their own because the leaders have disappeared a long way up the road. One of the Kenyans up there in the lead is a very interesting man at 33 years of age, Wesley Karia, or I should give him his exact title, and that is the Honourable Wesley Kipchumba Karia, because he won a seat as an independent member of the Kenyan Parliament in 2013. Ran fourth in the Boston Marathon this year, but he says he's got lofty ambitions. One day, he wants to be president of Kenya. Well, he'll be a Kenyan hero if he can do it today. And there is one of the more recognisable sights in the world. You wouldn't be seeing a lot if you were up there with Cristo Redentor, as that statue is known in this part of the world, Christ the Redeemer. But it is spectacular, guarding this wonderful city, and so many of the visitors have gone up there this week, and I think you found a very special way of having a look at the area up there.
Yeah, it was a little self-indulgent moment before the games began. I hardly ever do sightseeing when I come to a major championship, but we were here with 5 or 6 spare days, and I bit the bullet. There's a little replay there, that conversation between Kipchoge and Biwott. They get on really well, they're good friends. I'm not quite sure what they're remonstrating about, but not obviously overly happy with something there, but they're quite comfortable running in their pace. Yeah, it was a pretty good deal. If you've got 3 mates together, it was a very modest price, and you've got a 10-minute ride, and it was 10 minutes almost to the nose, a little ride in the helicopter. I was absolutely petrified, but it was a great moment before the games began. And I know many of the athletes, there's another two just having a chat, training partners. Kawanivi of Namibia. And so many of these guys do a lot of the hard yards together. And a lot of the athletes in many different sports and disciplines were talking about the fact that they must get up to Christ the Redeemer when their event's over. But I just hope there aren't too many who've tried to have a look up there today, because as you indicated, you may get a decent view of the statue, but you wouldn't get to see that fabulous panoramic of the city in an almost 360-degree view.
Up close and personal with the runners as they go through one of the drink stations. Things starting to thin out just a little bit. That lead pack is now occupying a fair bit more ground than it did around a couple of kilometres ago. So they've stepped up the pace just a little bit. These runners trying to stay in touch.
Now, there's always a debate about how you pronounce this guy's name. In Britain, we refer to him as Meb Kevilazigi, but I don't think that's how the Americans refer to him. Let's call him Meb for now. You've probably got your own version.
No, I'll go with you.
But Meb, what a fantastic athlete he's been. Remember that surprise silver when he finished behind Stefano Baldini in the original Olympic Stadium in Athens in 2004, and he's made the American team once again, and he certainly set the American distance running pulses racing when he won Boston in 2014. So he only just missed a medal in London as well. So when it comes to the Olympic Games, Meb is nearly always on form, and he looks sharp there at the front of the field.
It's just been a little injection of pace. Looks like one of the Moroccan runners. We'll get a better look at him in a moment, but he's just now intended to get a bit serious. It may very well be a Stefanos who's gone off the front. We'll get a better look at that as we get down to the lower angle camera. They've all been managing to get through the drink stations without too many issues. And despite the fact that it is raining and overcast, you stick to your procedures and certainly need to keep yourself hydrated.
You have got to drink in a marathon, even and especially when you don't feel thirsty, because as all of us are told by our mums when we're growing up, by the time you feel thirsty, you're already dehydrated. So it's little and often. Got to keep that water coming on board. The organisers have done a good job with this marathon because they laid on a variety of thin water spray showers, obviously banking on the fact that it would be absolutely roasting as it was for the women a week ago. But I think the elements are providing the little assistance with the showers today.
Well, they certainly did to us when we were trying to find our car this morning.
Yes. So very different conditions to that which greeted the women a week ago. It was absolutely brutal for them last weekend, which is why we had so many dropping out.
And there's one of the men from Burundi. 2084 is Celestine Nihumbiri. And a bit of a problem here.
It might just be the shoelace. Well, that would be a real shame if it is. I thought initially he was stopping for cramp, but to have an issue with your shoelace, or maybe is the transponder bothering you?
Yeah.
No, that's unbelievable. You hardly ever see that, someone actually having to stop, and he's having to use a lot of time there.
Well, that obviously was a problem. If you're going to sacrifice that much time, that was a problem that was going to affect his ability to be able to finish the race if it was going to continue. But yeah, that is a sacrifice of around half a minute or maybe a bit more, and then you've got to get your momentum back up again. And it's more than the transponder by the look of it for Daniel Maiucci. Now, he is one of the fancied Italians. He was up the front of the race before, so this is a shame.
A real shame, because he's class when it comes to the major events. Maiucci, European champion in 2014, and he and Pertile, the other Italian, who I think is still in that big group. There was just an indication there, the showers that they had on offer. Nobody really needed to take him up on the offer there. But Maiucci was eighth in Beijing last year. Pertile, the other Italian, was fourth. It was a great performance from both of them 12 months ago. That's a real shame.
Choi Pak, or Pak Choi, as we should say, to give them their correct name, the way that they go with their names, of the People's Republic of Korea, is up in the lead pack. He's a 2:12 athlete, has run 2:14.11 this year. The man from India, Tanakul Gopi, is trying to hang on to the back of the pack as well. His personal best time is 2:16.15, which has been recorded this year. So he's just on the back of that lead pack, but he doesn't want that piece of elastic to stretch out any further.
Actually, there's a growing tradition in distance running in India. Got great races, the 10K in Bangalore, half marathon in Delhi, and then the marathon in Mumbai every January. I know the Indian sports federations are working really hard. I mean, they've got a massive wealth of natural talent to try and draw on as far as the distance running races are concerned. So it is good to see Indian representation here. They've got some very good female 3,000 metre steeplechase athletes. Lalita Babar ran well last year in the World Championships.
Maradi trying to hang on. We just saw Gwar Marial of South Sudan also trying to hang on. He's a 2:14 runner. So just a couple of numbers being reduced from the lead pack. They haven't quite been consigned to no man's land yet, but they need to be careful. 13.8 kilometres in. It hasn't been breakneck speed, but it's been pretty persistent. 43 and a half minutes into the Olympic marathon of the Games of the 31st Olympiad in Rio de Janeiro, and the lead pack still with plenty there when they went through 10 kilometres. If you took it at 3 seconds difference between the first runner through and the end of the 3 second runners, there were 33 of them in the lead pack.
Career just looking fairly steady at the front, and well, when the wheels come off and you find yourself behind that lead group, that must be a really tough place to be. One thing we haven't had a chance to talk about yet, which we should mention, the Ethiopian team. Now, the Ethiopians quite happy just to let the likes of the Chinese run together and the Bahrainians, Osbilen there, the expatriated Turk. There's Bahanu just running on the right-hand side of picture there, and his compatriot Lalissa is just further back in that group. There was massive controversy in Ethiopia because they decided not to select Kenenisa Bekele. They went on times, and of course, every governing body in every nation is absolutely within their rights to do it how they see fit. But they went on times to choose the first and second athletes from Dubai. But sometimes, I think people in Ethiopia felt form and history had to be taken into account. And Kenenisa Bekele ran really well in the London Marathon. He'd only managed to put together about 3 months of decent training, and he came third. He found himself totally isolated behind that incredible race at the front between Eliud Kipchoge and Stanley Biwott. He came home in 2:06.36 for a cracking third place, and I think Bekele felt that he had done enough to justify selection, especially bearing in mind that he's a three-time Olympic champion, one over the five and two over the 10. And he said to the selectors, listen, if I have another 3 or 4 or 5 months training off the back of the 3 months that I've put together to run 2:06 plus change, I really think I'm in with a shout of doing something very special in obviously what would be my last Olympic Games. Anyway, the Ethiopians did not decide to select him. The third spot went to Faisa Lalissa, a bronze medalist in the marathon in Daegu, who I'm sure will do a fine job representing the Ethiopians. But this is how controversial it was. Even Haile Gabri Selassie, who is absolutely revered and the most mild-mannered man, he led the protests outside the Ethiopian Athletic Federation. It was a massive talking point in Ethiopia, but whatever the protests, whatever the validity of his chances of being included or getting in amongst the medals, Kenenisa Bekele, a fine Olympic champion in his day, is not here, and it's Lalissa of Ethiopia who has that third spot. And was there the start of a break there from Eliud Kipchoge?
Yeah, I think he was starting to get interested up the front of the field to try and put the pace on. And look at the splintering of the group here. It's Kipchoge on the right of your picture in the white cap up near the front of the race. And look at the way this lead group has splintered. So this is a big moment in the structure of the race at 15 kilometres. We'll get the time in a moment, but Kipchoge has really decided it's time to go as they come up to that bend and go around the hairpin bend on this loop again, and it's caused a real fracture in the main body of the field. And so this is the first serious move of the race. They go through 15 kilometres in 46.53.
Yeah, so it's still, what, 2:11 pace, and obviously maybe just a shade inside. And obviously Eliud Kipchoge thought, right, OK, enough's enough. And now, well, we were wondering when the break would come. Well, it's not necessarily a break for gold because there are still many, many athletes alongside him. But Kipchoge has obviously decided, or maybe it was a predetermined scenario that he said to the others in the team, to Stanley Biewott and the rest, OK, look, we'll stick with the rest until we get to around 15K, and then we stop messing about and we turn it into a proper race. It's early. It is early to suddenly start putting it up there. Callum Hawkins still in that group. Pertile, the other of the Italians, running well. And remember, he got very close to a medal last year in Beijing, albeit in rather different conditions. So, well, we were wondering how the plan of the race would unfold. And this is it. They decided that at 15K, it's time to mean business. And Bahanu was just looking behind there, running on the right of picture, just to see if he could get a glimpse of one or two of his compatriots. And it's a bearer just behind him. But immediately there has been an impact by that little injection, almost effortless injection of pace from Eliud Kipchoge.
These are the men up in the top 10 at the moment. Kipchoge, Bahanu of Ethiopia, Bekele of Bahrain, Gebrselassie, who we'd expect to be there, of Eritrea. Galen Rupp was fifth through at 15 kilometres. Messel of Eritrea, Biewott of Kenya, El Hissouf of Morocco, Ozbilen of Turkey, and Barkowet of Azerbaijan. They are the first 10 through at the 15 kilometre mark, and the race has changed complexion all of a sudden.
Yeah, this is great. It certainly makes it interesting from a viewing perspective.
And obviously, just doing some sums too, it was 15.45 that last kilometre, so they've gone 15.31, 15.37, 15.45, but the next one's going to be a fair bit quicker by the look of it. And Kipchoge saying, all right, where's my compatriots? And just, he's giving the instructions, he's giving the riding instructions.
Well, I tell you what, it certainly makes it appear as though he's running very, very confidently here. Calling for his individual drink. That's absolutely vital. The water's fine, but they have their own tailor-made drinks concoctions that they're used to training with. But I think Kipchoge's bossing this race here as they head up towards, well, they're not a million miles away from the halfway stage, a guard of honour as they make their way round the streets of Rio de Janeiro. Everything we're seeing and witnessing from Eliud Kipchoge at the moment indicates he's feeling in fabulous shape. Well, you would expect that because he's run numerous times inside 205, so he should be feeling comfortable at high 210s or low 211s. But it's the confidence with which he's going around his work here. Just second from the left-hand side there, Kipchoge, running alongside Callum Hawkins. Great to see the young Briton not afraid to mix it at the front of the race. And it's good to see all the European nations who are represented here in this top group. There aren't an awful lot of them, but it's really important for young European distance runners to believe that they can mix it with the East Africans. Of course, the Ethiopians and the Kenyans and the Eritreans have raised the bar in recent years. They have. It's indicative of the fact that they've got so many top places. But you look at the likes of Paula Radcliffe 5-10 years ago, it is possible for European distance runners to still get in the mix, especially when you come to a major championship, because the emphasis is not on a time trial, the emphasis is on the gold medal, and that is really the quickest race to run. So that is fantastic to see a Briton at the front of the field, not from my perspective because he's British, because he's European and he's not afraid to have a go.
And we also saw one of the runners from Iran who's now tucked back in about 10th or 12th place. He took it up there for a while, and that was Mohammad Jafar Maradi. He's a 2:17 runner. Finished 28th in the Dubai Marathon last year, second in the Stockholm Marathon last year. He didn't finish at the World Championship, so he feels as though he's entitled to be up there in the rarefied air. Kipchoge still looking very comfortable, though, but then again, so are some of the other big names, the likes of Bahanu and Bekele and Gebrselassie and Rupp, for that matter. So most of the people who were contenders for medals still very much in the hunt, as you would expect after just more than 50 minutes of this marathon. And we head up towards the 17 kilometre stage. We're on the 10K loop, and we'll continue to be there through until the 35 kilometre mark.
Yes, and it will start to get interesting. Well, it already is, but it will start to have its second wind, this race. you saw just how quickly an athlete of the class of Eliud Kipchoge can impact on a race just by that seemingly effortless acceleration. And he has spat, what, 10, maybe even 15 guys straight out the back of that lead group. Many of them running within their capability, but only just at 2:11. But now we're beginning to whittle this group down bit by bit, one by one. Callum Hawkins deciding to hit the front. He ran inside 2:11 for that performance in London, 2:10.52. 15th in the World Half Marathon Championships in Cardiff, a race won by the brilliant Geoffrey Kamworor. And Hawkins just going over for the water, but Kipchoge on that occasion deciding he doesn't need a drink.
All sorts of action going on there, people crisscrossing the road. And again, the Asian nations, a couple of Chinese runners up there. We've got one Japanese runner. That's one thing that we've been able to do very easily throughout these Olympic Games, and that is identify the Japanese runners, because their strip, I think you could not only see it here in Rio, you could see it from Mars. Very colourful and always easy to identify. So the journey is a long way into its passage, but there's still a long, long way to go. Some brilliant images coming your way from the games of the 31st Olympiad. Wonderful to have your company as we head towards the halfway stage of the marathon.
Callum Hawkins, what a display of confidence this is. Cracking run in London. I think he may have even beaten Dennis Kimeto in that race, the reigning world record holder. The wheels came off for him towards the closing stages. This is the view from the back of that group. Not quite such a comfortable ride for this particular section of the field. They've come off the back of that lead group, and they now find themselves having to dig deep a little bit as we edge towards the halfway stage.
And that man Chipangama is a 2:11 athlete at his best. Hasn't done that this year, 2:17.39, but he's finding it difficult to stay on. Again, looking at the splits when they went through 15 kilometres, we took it down to 10 seconds, and there were 58 runners within 10 seconds of the lead. 3 seconds is the gap that we've been talking about, though, and that has been reduced to just the 19 runners. There is the sole Netherlands representative.
And he's a good athlete. He was sixth in the European half. 2:10, and just ahead of him is Pertile, Rogério Pertile, fourth last year in Beijing, just missing a medal. He's 41 years of age. He might even be tickling towards 42 now, still going well. Seventh in the Europeans a couple of years ago. So he's just become detached from that lead group. One or two big names finding that little subtle injection of pace tough to live with. And you can see the photographers who go around the course on the back of the open top truck so that they can get their photos, trying to second guess which of the athletes will win. They'll get a whole array of shots of all of them in case it turns out to be the photo that they want tomorrow in the papers, if it isn't the one of them actually crossing the finish line.
Pertile, in fact, has just had his 42nd birthday. In fact, he had it earlier in these Olympic Games, just 2 weeks ago.
So what a performance to still be operating at this level.
Yeah.
At the age of 42. And Bernard Lagarde almost picking up a medal at the age of 41.
Well, he thought he did have one for a while last night in controversial circumstances, but he was elevated to third and then went back to fifth. But one of his quotes was, well, if they turn around and take it off me, then I'll still be happy.
Well, I suppose you can afford to have that view if you've already got a couple of Olympic medals, as he has done for Kenya over the 1500 in recent times in Sydney and in Athens. But it is good to see athletes still managing to compete at the top level in their early 40s.
2012, Hakeem Saadi getting off the back. 21:44 is the Brazilian Marilson dos Santos. Now, he's a 2:06 runner, so he's trying to stay onto the back of this lead pack, and he's managing to do that just at the moment. But it has been splintered.
Well, they went for it, didn't they? And then they just eased back again. But even just that temporary extension of pace spat a few runners off the back of that group. What a day it is for De Santos. He's won the New York a couple of times, although that was a few years ago. He's 39 years of age, and it's his very last race. He was fifth in London. So the Brazilian said he will give it absolutely everything. He's only just turned 39. What a way to mark your retirement. You're a Brazilian marathon runner. You've come close to medals in the past, and you have an opportunity to sign off in style in your own Olympic Games. And there he is, just towards the back of that lead group, still headed at the moment by the Scot, Callum Hawkins, not afraid to flex his muscles in front of Eliud Kipchoge, the overwhelming favourite for the gold.
And to give you an indicator of their respective personal best times, Callum Hawkins, 2:10.52, is recorded that this year though, so he's in good shape. And Kipchoge, naturally enough, with a better time than that, 2:03.05 in the London Marathon. So he's doing a good job, Hawkins, to remain at the head of the field. They're whittling them away, 155 started from 80 different nations. We've already had a couple. Miucci of Italy won't finish. Andrei Petrov of Uzbekistan also pulled out between the 10 and the 15 kilometre mark. So a couple of casualties. 155 has been whittled to 153. And there'll be a fair bit more attrition between now and the finish as we come up to the 1 hour mark.
Yes, we may not get quite the same number of dropouts that we had in the women's race, where 24 failed to finish, but the conditions not as brutal, although there are always one or two whose race begins to unravel. And there is Dos Santos, 2:14.44, hanging on to the back of that group. Great day for him, a proud day. Such a long career that has brought him glory in the United States and brought him so close to the podium in London, behind Stephen Kiprotich in fifth place.
And by the look of it, he's got one of his compatriots up there in Solonay da Silva as well, who is also a 2:11.5 runner. So they'll be good company for each other as they try to maintain their position in this lead pack, which numbers, well, we're only guessing, but probably 25 to 30 runners. Down past this beautiful, picturesque part of the city. They are in loop number 2 of the 10-kilometre loop.
Ospilén, second from the right-hand side. Ramos is running a very aggressive race there on the extreme right of picture. And still, Callum Hawkins, the arrowhead of this lead group, as they once again run alongside Botafogo Bay. It really is the most stunning place to come and visit. What a backdrop for a marathon, and what a backdrop for an Olympic Games.
Have a look at that. That's that geography we were talking about. Everywhere you look around Rio, you see images like that. And they've got some company on the inside. We did have some issues the other day with people leaping the barriers in the last 3 or 4 kilometres in the straight stretch that takes them down towards the Sambadrome on Avenue Presidente Vargas. Hopefully we won't have anything similar today. Don't need that ruined.
Yeah, but believe me, whoever that guy is, he won't be there for very long. He'd have to be a pretty decent club runner to be living with that for 2 or 3 miles.
Yes. I was just thinking about people suffering unfortunate endings to marathons. Well, remember Vandelay de Lima, the man who lit the flame at the Maracanã. Was it really more than 2 weeks ago? But he was the man on whom the eyes of the world were focused. And of course, he had his own terrible endings to races, but became a national hero because of the way he handled himself.
He was brilliant. He was in the lead, wasn't he, in Athens in the baking heat with Turgat and Stefano Baldini trying to close him down, and then The man jumped over the barrier, pushed him to the ground, but De Lima was so sporting about that. He got a special presentation, and he did brilliantly to hang on for the bronze. I think he said afterwards, in a really gracious, magnanimous gesture, he said, look, they were closing anyway. It wasn't as if it completely disrupted my rhythm and I suddenly had the gold snatched away from me. I'm still delighted to have the bronze. And I was in the stadium to watch the end of that race. Fantastic win for Baldini, replicating the exploits of Gelindo Bourdin, the other legendary Italian from 88. And watching De Lima come into the stadium, having seen him be pushed over on the big screen, was incredible. He was leaning from left to right as he came down the home chute, waving his arms around, pretending to be an aeroplane. It was an amazing end to the race. And so rather fitting that he was the man to light the flame. There was a lot of talk that it would be Pelé. But what a moment for De Lima, a fabulous ambassador for his country and for the sport of marathon running.
Through the 20-kilometre mark at 1 hour, 2 minutes, 27 seconds, that kilometre was quicker. They went through the third 5K in 15:45, that 5K 15:34, and it was at the start of that K the injection of pace came from Kipchoge, which splintered the field a little bit.
So 2:102.27, yeah, so it's still just inside 2:11 pace, but you suspect it will begin to crank up a little bit. If you are just joining us and you're thinking, hang on a minute, this is a bit slow. I remember watching London. I've seen these guys knock out 204s, 205s. Only four Olympic marathons have been won in a time inside 2 hours, 10 minutes. Wanjiru set the fastest of all with a wonderful win in Beijing, 206.32. Kipchoge, 208.01. And then you have to go back to Carlos Lopez. Remember the Portuguese athlete winning in 1984 in LA with 209.21, and Sierpinski of Germany won the first of his two golds in 76 in 209.55. So these races do not have a history of being fast. They're competitive and they're compelling, but this isn't about times, it's about the Olympic gold medal.
The Ethiopian runner at the front of the field is the winner of the Boston Marathon this year, Lemmy Berhanu. 2:04.33 is his best time, and it was a slowly run race in Boston, and he was able to kick in the last 3 kilometres and win there. So this time is probably feeling something similar to Boston for him.
Yeah, they've brought a great team, the Ethiopians, despite the fact that there's no place for Kenenisa Bekele. And I just noticed Stephen Kipchoge poking his nose at the front of that field as well. Still very much in the hunt for Olympic gold number two. What a story that would be for the Ugandans. And there he is now leading the field, his compatriot Kiprop, Jackson Kiprop, who was 10th in the last two editions of the World Championships. And you can always tell the Ugandans because they've got that very nice, distinctive, bright yellow vest. And it's great to have so many world-class Ugandans because they are a very proud distance-running nation. They haven't enjoyed the level of success that the Kenyans and Ethiopians have produced on the track and the roads in recent years, but Kipchoge at the forefront of a new generation of Ugandan distance runners, and there'll be huge excitement in Kampala and Jinja and all the other places around Uganda where they have the training camps. They'll be delighted to see their man once again in the mix towards the front of the field and still in with a chance, but there are so many others still there, and including in that list, Eliud Kipchoge, by far and away the fastest man in the world this year and the most consistent performer over the last three seasons.
At halfway, we are just under 2:12 pace for the marathon now. 1:05.55, Korea of Kenya taking us through with the same time as Kipchoge of Uganda, Kipchoge of Kenya, Mesil of Eritrea, Dong Guo Jian of China is also up there in the top 10. Gala of Djibouti is there. Pacheco of Peru is also up in that lead pack, along with Jackson Kiprop, Biwott of Kenya, and Özbilen of Turkey.
Oh, that's a real shame. That's the expatriated Eritrean who went to Scotland in 2008. What a shame. He's had to bring his race to a close there. Not going as well as his compatriot Callum Hawkins.
That's Segai to Veldi.
I wonder whether he'll get up and manage to finish. So we now have a number of casualties here, and the former Eritrean is one of them. So no continuation you suspect there for him, but they plough on at the front. And one by one, there will be more. There was another quick flash there of an athlete. Oh, that's Meb. Meb's running into problems. The silver medalist from Athens, and what a shame for him. He'll bravely carry on, but he was looking great. Not, well, what, 3-4 kilometres ago, right up in that lead group, and suddenly Meb has been spat out the back. So even though the pace isn't particularly quick, this is why the marathon is such compelling viewing, because you just never know how certain athletes' bodies are going to respond to the rigours of 26.2 miles on the roads of whatever city it's taking place in.
So Meb, or Keflezighi, if you like, from the United States, that athlete who's got himself into some issues and may not be able to finish. We've seen a couple of little incidents in the last couple of kilometres. Things are starting to take their toll. We're past the halfway stage. They're looking at about 2:12 pace or thereabouts. All of the big guns, or most of them, are up there, even though we're missing the Italian Maiucci, just looking down the bottom of the field, and still just the two retirements at this stage. Maiucci of Italy, Petrov of Uzbekistan are the men who will not finish.
Messel just holding his hands up there, making sure he gets his drink. Kipchoge and Biwott still look so, so comfortable. That's Ozbilen, who flies the flag for Turkey. And DeSantos and the rest of the Brazilians will get an absolutely massive reception when they return to the finish, however far down the field they are.
It's a great national flag, the Brazilian flag. We've seen it so often, not only at the stadium, but also at various other venues, and indeed wherever you walk around. Now we've got another runner here with a shoelace or a transponder problem.
It's Mini Kenenisa. It's Bekele of Bahrain having to stop and tie his shoelace up, and he doesn't look as though he's got problems. He's straight back into his running, and he'll try and remember that coach's guide. Don't get back in to your full running. Don't sprint to catch them up. Try and do it gradually, because that way you use up less emotional, nervous energy. That was simply a shoelace, as opposed to Meb, who we saw stopping earlier on and clearly running into issues. Well, you can't take your eyes off this race for a second.
No, all sorts of things happening. Some of it to do with equipment, some of it to do with the body. And I think Hawkins just got himself into a bit of a squeeze there and had to pull to the other side of the road as well. So we're slowly whittling them away.
And actually, what we should mention here, there's the back of Turfe Abera. There he is in the yellow, not the athlete in the red. And he's come off the back of that group, and he's the third fastest athlete in the world this year after winning Dubai in 2:04.24. So the Ethiopians, there he is. He's just running alongside, now emerging from the trees alongside. There he is on the right-hand side there. One of the fastest athletes in the world this year. Of course, he could just be going through a bad patch and may well make his way back up to that group. But I think something's not quite right with Abera, because there's no other reason why he would be letting a gap like this grow between himself and the lead group.
Well, look at Bekele. He's having trouble with his shoelaces again. That has come undone by the look of it. So he stopped to pay attention to it round about 300 or 400 metres ago, but it doesn't look as though he's done the job. And he may very well have to stop again and try and get it done up, or he just forget about it and keep on going. Now he's got himself back onto the lead pack. No time for stopping a second time.
So, Abera, there he is. Probably the first of the big casualties to fall off the back of that group. We'll keep our eye on it and see whether he manages to close up, but it's inevitable. Despite the fact that these guys have run lightning quick times, if something is ever so slightly wrong, or you wake up and it's just not quite clicking, it is very easy for your race to unravel. But still, Eliud Kipchoge and Stanley Biwott of Kenya, and the defending champion Stephen Kiprotich of Uganda, all right up there at the front of that field. And Callum Hawkins, well, great confidence this. I think you're right, he was running in the pack and maybe had too many people around him. Stanley Biewott, by the way, is moving far over to the far left-hand side of picture. He's the second fastest athlete in this field, and that may be just to get clean air, or it may be because there's a drink station approaching. So Hawkins dropped back and wide and clearly decided that he just wanted to make sure he had clean and clear road around him at the front of that field. So still a big, big group here, but one by one, they're coming off the back.
But Galen Rupp is not amongst them. He's been up at the forefront of the race. There he is, right in the middle of your picture there. The tall American in the white cap, running brilliantly. The time will be to his liking. He's got the Kenyans around him, of course. He's got the great Brit runner for company in Hawkins. But he's a quality athlete, Galen Rupp. It's an interesting point you make about maybe you're just not feeling quite right. I've spoken to athletes over the years and they say on the morning of a race they feel terrible when they go down to the start line, and yet they tend to run really well. And sometimes the opposite can be the case. You feel absolutely magnificent going to the starting line, feel as though this is going to be your day, and all of a sudden the wall comes out and hits you 10 kilometres before you even thought it would get near you.
Yeah, that sometimes there is no explanation and no rhyme or reason, no matter how well your training's gone. And certainly, Terfe Abera is off the back of that group, and DeSantos will try and use him as a reel to get a few more places further up the field. So, what a pack we've got here. There's Gabri Selassie, just to the right of Eliud Kipchoge, to Kipchoge's left. He's the reigning world champion. Kipchoge's the fastest man in the world this year. And we've got Stanley Biewott, second from the left-hand side, the second fastest athlete in the world this year. And we've got Galen Rupp, making his Olympic marathon debut after winning the trials in Los Angeles in February and coming up just shy of another medal over the 10,000 metres on the track. There's real intrigue, and there are some great stories emerging from that lead group, and we're not too far away from getting towards the business end of this race.
And Galen Rupp has got Jared Ward, another fellow American for company. He's a 2:13 runner, but again, we tend to throw out the personal best times when the race is being run at this pace, because they're running at a 2:12 pace. We know that the big guns will probably more likely have a better kick, but this brings the 2:13 runners and the 2:12 runners into contention for a medal here.
But what we can say here, Osbilen still right up there. Remember, 2:06 plus change now represents Turkey, the former Kenyan, just glancing over, and Lalissa still very much in the mix. So we still have two Ethiopians in this lead group. What we can say here definitively is that if the likes of Kipchoge and Biewott running on the left of picture are feeling good, when the injection of pace comes,
yeah,
it will be absolutely brutal, and it will almost instantly split this pack, because the reason that pack is so big is that some of the men within it are running just within their comfort zone. But the likes of Kipchoge, who's run 2:03 and 2:04 and 2:05, he will be feeling so good at this pace, presumably if he's 100% fit, that when he goes, he can afford to do so in a quite spectacular fashion. And when it happens, it will be fascinating to see how many of this group immediately get pushed out the back.
Yeah, that's a very good point. It's the hope of the 2:12 runners that maybe not everything is right. Now, we have another casualty here, and it's one of the Ethiopians, Abera. So it is turning into a race of attrition, and it's claiming some of the big names as well. We've already seen Maiucci of Italy, the man who finished eighth in the World Championships last year, go by the board. And things are starting to get difficult. Abera, 2:04.24. He's run that this year, and he's not going to get to the finish line.
So three Ethiopians, now down to just two. And when will the acceleration come? And will it come from the overwhelming favourite for the gold, Eliud Kipchoge? It has to happen at some stage. And there's Bekele. You've just got a glimpse there. Bekele's shoelace. Although, and it's still flapping. So the Bahrainian, the former Ethiopian, either hasn't noticed or he's decided that he wants to just let it be, and he'll soldier on. He doesn't want to interrupt his rhythm again a second time to do up the lace.
Yeah, I suspect that's the case, because he gave up so much ground the first time, and it's very hard to restart the engines a second time once you've got off the back of the pack. He did a good job of getting back onto the lead pack within the space of probably about 700 or 800 metres, and he doesn't want to have that task again. You can't afford to make too many runs when you've got the quality up the front of the field that occupies the lead positions at the moment. And here are more men being splintered off the main group. 28.04 is Sondre Norstad Moen of Norway. Also one of the Belgian runners there. 21.95, also getting off the back, is Reed Colsate of Canada. Now he's gone 2:10.28. Here's the hairpin turn. Can often cause an injection of pace and just try to give a little surge and get rid of a couple more off the lead pack. Ethiopians down to two. Ugandans are all still there. Kenyans are all still there. The Brazilians are running together. There's the Japanese. Many nations involved. 1:18.12. They go through the next split.
It's still very, very steady. Mebs could manage to get running again. He's got Dos Santos just behind him, the American silver medalist from Athens, but his quest for gold is surely over after having to stop and running into some problems.
15:45, that kilometre.
It's got to get faster,
yeah,
because there are too many of them here. And Eliud Kipchoge, you suspect, won't wait too much longer before making his move. And he may not be the only one, because he's not the only athlete who can comfortably run well inside 2:10 in that lead group. There's a bearer, a sad end to his race. He's clearly not feeling very well, maybe has some stomach issues there. 2:04.24 at the start of the year, but when you're not feeling well, it doesn't matter if you're running way outside your PB. A real shame for the Ethiopian. You cannot take it for granted here in this marathon, irrespective of the fact that they're running outside 2:10.
And we've got 37 men still within 9 seconds of the lead, but then there's a little gap from the 9 second runners out to 12 and 13 and 14, and then there's a gap of 8 seconds between 14 and 22. So the field has been fractured up the front, but there are still 37 in that lead pack within a few seconds of each other.
Well, we've said this already, but Bekele's shoelace is still undone, but he's quite happy running alongside Wesley Carrier, who's going well at the moment, looks pretty comfortable. When this injection of pace comes, it is going to be something to behold, because they are going to really, really go for it. Kipchoge will be itching to accelerate here. He hasn't run a marathon this slowly. He's only run 7 in total. His slowest time is 2:05.30. So he's in uncharted territory here, but for the other reason, he's in uncharted territory because this is on course to be 6 minutes, 5 or 6 minutes, which is well over a mile by the speed he runs at, well over a mile slower than he's used to running. So he's experiencing this type of race for the first time, because so far it's all been big city stuff. Hamburg, wins in Berlin, Rotterdam, Chicago, twice in London. So it's a different kind of race for Eliud Kipchoge, and he'll be running there. And if he's feeling good, so camera's focusing on De Silva working his way back towards that lead group, which is great news for the Brazilian. Kipchoge, presumably, if he is fully fit and looks fairly comfortable from his body language, he will be itching to go and to accelerate. And there he is at the front.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see whether he has a predetermined point, whether it is on one of the bends or just after one of the bends on this circuit, or whether it's just a matter of him feeling when he's feeling at his best and making the decisive move there. But you do suspect that this really is going to splinter. Now, Mebs got himself going again.
Wonder whether he's just leaning slightly heavily on that right leg, which has the cool-looking kinetic tape that says USA on it, but he's clearly had some issues. I give him what, especially holding up the camera, 200 metres?
Yeah, that's what you call a very difficult tracking shot to perform. A think we'll stick with our cameras, and we've got every angle covered here.
So we are coming up to the last 15K here, and this is going to be a time trial by the standards that these guys run at. And there are a few just coming off the back, but there are still some, 20 or so men in that group. And Eliud Kipchoge, you can tell it's him because he's still wearing his white baseball cap. Oh, and Mebs had to stop again. I thought he might have been leaning a little heavily on that right leg. He's been a brilliant ambassador for American distance running for a very, very long time. And the shoelace saga continues for Bekele.
Well, I wonder whether it's got anything to do with that transponder, because we've seen a couple of athletes having just some small problems with it. Just repeating what we told you early in the race, and that is that the athletes are officially timed by a transponder which is on their shoe. And so whether that is causing any difficulty with the laces is something that only he can tell. Now he's right up beside those motorbikes at the back, and so yet again he's faced with the task of using the runners in front of him to try and latch onto their backs for a while and then pick off the next target who's about 15 metres in front of them. But then he's got a gap of about 30 metres, which is foreshortened by the camera angle to the Brazilians. So there's a good illustration of it. He's going to have to make another run, and you can't do that too often in this quality of field.
And the other point to make about that, whilst it is still around about or just outside 2:11 pace, that's manageable. But when the acceleration comes, it will be an impossible margin for him to make up. So a real disappointment there for the Ethiopian now representing Bahrain.
Brazilians are just hanging on to the back here.
Yeah, doing really well. De Silva and Paula wearing 2:1:50. He was 8th in London and 7th in Moscow. So the two Brazilians just running at the back of shot there, now running past that red boarding. And is this the beginning of a little move here from Eliud Kipchoge? Or is he just staying out the way of the drink station?
Yeah, well, it's possible, but drink stations sometimes are where these things can happen. Rupps look really comfortable so far. As a track athlete, as a 5 and 10K runner, when the explosion comes, the inevitable explosion, which is getting closer as we speak, you think Rupp will have the tactical speed to go with it, given the fact that he's already run. There's a bit of argy-bargy going on just behind the leaders there too. Given the fact that he's already run in these games and he's got some miles in his legs, do you think he'll have the speed to go with the explosion when it happens?
Yeah, in terms of the acceleration, I think he'd be able to cover it, because this will feel, at the moment, bearing in mind we've still got 15K to go, right at the beginning of this race, especially having run at the 10,000 metre pace and come fifth and not been too far away from the podium. It wasn't a shabby run from Rupp in the final of the 10. This would have felt absolutely pedestrian at the start. But the longer this race goes, the more the likes of Galen Rupp is going to feel it when the acceleration comes. So I think initially, in terms of the raw speed, when Kipchoge, if it is Kipchoge, steps on the gas, Rupp will be able to go with him initially. The question will come, in this only his second marathon, will he have enough in the tank to sustain that long enough to hang in the mix for a medal? And by the way, we should say, what an unbelievable achievement it would be for Galen Rupp. The Americans haven't won a medal since Frank Shorter came within a whisker of doing the double. He won in Munich, of course, and then finished second to Chiapinski, who won in Montreal inside 2:10. So it's been a very long time, 40 years, since the Americans have finished on the podium. So what an achievement that would be. But we can't really start talking about that until we've seen what injection will eventually come.
And that's Bekele. So maybe the troubles are more than shoelaces. So some of the big names are dropping by the way here. Abera is out, Tevelde is out, Mayuchi and Petrov. And now Bekele. It seems as though he's run his race. And this lead pack is reducing in number.
And the reason the cameras are focusing on 3:019, that's the defending champion, Stephen Kiprotich, nearest the camera, and he has become detached from the lead group. The other two Ugandans are still up there. Solomon Mutai, who got the bronze last year in Beijing, and Jackson Kiprop, who's been really consistent in recent years. But we will not see, I don't think, a successful title defence from Stephen Kiprotich. At this pace, he wouldn't allow a gap like that to grow, especially when he knows he's got the two fastest men in the field at the front in Eliud Kipchoge and Stanley Biwott. So one by one, they are beginning to fall off the back here. And I think Kipchoge might be in the process of winding this up. It hasn't been the sudden, spectacular explosion of pace, but I think he must be gearing it up gradually here. And certainly the defending Olympic champion has been spat out the back.
We're down to a dozen, maybe 15 runners. The American, Jared Ward, is trying to hang in there and maybe keep the back of his compatriot in Galen Rupp. We've already seen that the defending champion from 2008, Stephen Kiprotich, is having trouble staying on. Another one of the Ugandans also having trouble staying on. So there's only one Ugandan in the lead pack. And we're getting down to about a dozen now. So there has certainly been an acceleration. It's been a gradual one, and it's getting rid of a few. And this is one of the pivotal moments of the race so far.
Yes, and it's Jackson Kiprop who's fallen off the back. Twice 10th in World Championship marathons. And just like his compatriot Stephen Kiprotich, he's beginning to struggle here. So of the three Ugandans who started the race, it's only Solomon Mutai, but I say only, he got the bronze in Beijing last year behind Gurme Gebrselassie of Eritrea, who, by the way, has kept very quiet and not been at the front, but he's right up there in that group. So we may have lost the reigning Olympic champion from this lead group, but the reigning world champion is right there, still in the mix and still in with a hunt of an Olympic gold medal to go alongside his world title. He's running behind Stanley Biwott there, so you can't really see him, but he is still there in that group. So it is about 12 now.
And we had a South African up there at the 25-kilometre mark. It looks as though he may have lost contact now with the leaders in that group, and that was Sibusiso Nzima, the 29-year-old.
And we've just seen the Peruvian, one of the Peruvian brothers, Christian Pacheco. He's dropped back from that lead group.
And no, this is serious stuff now.
Yeah, this is it. This is their bold bid to try and run the sting out of everyone. And suddenly Jared Ward, having looked so good, he's beginning to struggle and has allowed 20 or 30 metres to grow between himself and the rest of the field. And there's the world champion.
Yeah, that's Gebrselassie. So he has got himself off the back. Well, this is a surprise. The reigning world champion all of a sudden finds himself in no man's land. It's not over yet for him, but he doesn't want that gap to grow any bigger.
Wow. So Gebrselassie suddenly finds himself running into problems. And the Eritrean flag is being flown well at the moment in that lead group. I think that might be a Stefanos right at the back, but still in touch with that group at the moment. Gebrselassie, you can see, working very hard to try and get back on level terms. He's just emerging from behind that tree now, but he needs to close that gap quite soon. We've only got some 13 kilometers to go, and the two big men who, metaphorically speaking, tore chunks off each other in the London Marathon in April. It was one of the great races, it really was. A wonderful spectacle, and they are leading at the moment. The two fastest men in the world this year, two of the fastest six in history, and they are the ones now dominating the pace, and they're dictating the tempo, and that is why so many athletes have become detached from this group so quickly. And what about Galen Rupp?
He looks still so
right
comfortable.
There.
Yeah. The man that we all expect to go closest to the goal, Kipchoge, is also looking comfortable, and he has from the word go. But Rupp is such a stylist. He's a beautiful runner to watch, both on the track and on the road. And he's kept his form all the way. He's coped with the gradual increase in the pace. Kipchoge at some stage will probably throw in a move which he hopes will drop off even the very best, and he's managed to do that with the world champion in Gebrselassie, who's off the back of this pack now.
Yeah, his quest has gone, I think.
Yeah.
He wouldn't have allowed a gap that big to grow.
A couple more going off too.
Yes, it's Messel, the Eritrean. I thought it was Estefanos, but it's actually Messel who's now allowed the gap to grow. Simbu of Tanzania just glancing at his watch. It'll be a war of attrition for him for the next, 40 minutes or so. That's a lot of running when your legs are feeling tired.
Well, he's a 2:09 runner, and he's gone 2:09 this year. So that gives you a good indicator of how stiff this pace has become. Barkawet of Azerbaijan also getting off the back and getting into a territory where that piece of elastic which attaches him to the main body of the field is about to be broken. And so we had a dozen a little while ago. We're probably down to about 8 now. And by the look of things, it might keep on being reduced.
Yes, it's about 8, isn't it?
Yeah.
And 8 into 3 does not go. And it's one of the Ethiopians now who's decided to take it on. Berhanu, the man who was second in Dubai, behind Abera, his compatriot, who's dropped out. So 1:33 plus bits for the 30K checkpoint, and it's still way outside 2:10 pace, and there's an opportunity for one or two of these athletes to do something very special. And I think this may have helped Galen Rupp, because bearing in mind Rupp has only run one marathon, the conditions were absolutely brutal in LA, and I'm sure he ran 2:11 plus change. So he'll be feeling comfortable at this pace, especially when you bear in mind he's used to running much faster, albeit over the shorter 10K distance on the track.
The Swiss, Tedesse Abraham, was the man who was in ninth place. He was just off the back of the leading eight. We'll check in with his progress when we get back to the leaders in a moment. The lead eight are Berhanu of Ethiopia, Kipchoge of Kenya. We have Ulessa of Ethiopia, Osbilin of Turkey, Rupp of the United States, Biwott of Kenya, Korea of Kenya, and Mutai of Uganda. And now the Swiss looks as though he's gone back.
It's Osbilen of Turkey. So he's been dropped.
Yeah, so we're now 7.
Just out of picture. Wow.
Well, this is a serious increase in pace now. And it has been somewhat gradual. Let's have a look for the time for that last kilometre. The last kilometre, 15:03. So that is by far the quickest K, or 5K of the race, for that split between 25 and 30 kilometres. So the 5K in 15:03.
That's why so many have become detached. Abraham of Switzerland has gone, and so too Osbilen, the Kenyan representing Turkey. And there's a little bit of a move here from Lemmy Berhanu, the winner in Boston this year. He was only 15th in the World Championships last year. And suddenly we are down to just 5. And this is where it gets really interesting. This is where the questions begin to be asked. Galen Rupp, well, it looked as though he'd thrown off his cap there. I wonder whether someone's passed him another one. Getting his liquid on board, and Korea has moved off the back there. And so too has Stanley Biwott. Now it could just be that he's making his way back up gradually, having taken a drink. We'll have to wait and see his body language here and how quickly he closes the gap. If that gap doesn't close relatively soon, then maybe Biwott's running into problems. And look at that, Berhanu was motioning there. I'm not sure whether it was to his compatriot Lalisa or whether it was to Eliud Kipchoge. I'm sure we might get to see that again. He turned and said, well, presumably in Amharic, come on, come on. So he's feeling as though they need to go faster. So Biwott second from the back of that group, and Galen Rupp just behind him. Osbilen and Abraham are going to have a torrid time getting in now. Osbilen's really struggling. You can tell by his cadence, just rocking and rolling left and right a little bit. But we need to watch to see whether Rupp and Biwott are back in that group and it was simply a case of them having a drink, or whether they too are beginning to struggle.
Mutai, the lone Ugandan now. They had 3 up in the lead pack for a while. But now even he's starting to get off the back of the pack. And this gradual acceleration, they're really starting to put the hammer down now. This is what you were talking about a moment ago.
So, is he doing that in the direction of Kipchoge or his compatriot Lalisa? He's doing it again. I think he wants Kipchoge to do his turn at the front. Well, it tells you one thing. Kipchoge, by the way, didn't give him any reaction whatsoever, did he? He was focusing on his own race. It tells you at least that Bahanu's really up for this.
Rupp's still able to hang on to the lead three. He's in the lead four. But the two men getting off the back here, Mutai starting to look as though he's feeling the strain a bit. And also Korea is getting off too. So now it's starting to look as though we might be down to five. Probably just a little bit too early to say that. But the one thing you can say is that Galen Rupp of the United States is looking very comfortable. How much will he have left in his legs at the kick?
I'm not surprised, actually. In terms of the three Kenyans, if you look at what they've done in recent times, Biwott and Eliud Kipchoge would be the more fancied of the trio. So if anyone was going to drop off the back of that in terms of the Kenyans, then it would be Wesley Korea. And Kipchoge casting off the hat. Now, I was mentioning earlier parallels with Alain Mimoun. He's caught that. That better not go on eBay. That's a piece of sporting memorabilia. I was mentioning Alain Mimoun, who went in search of his maiden Olympic gold, having had bronze and silver medals on the track behind Zatopek. He famously cast off a hanky that he was using to shade his head from the sun towards the end of the marathon in Melbourne, and that was the moment he believed he was going to strike gold. So a little bit whimsical, but there are parallels between Eliud Kipchoge and Alain Mimoun. He couldn't quite climb the mountain on the track like the great Frenchman, but maybe he can do it here on the roads of Rio. Korea's battle for gold is gone. He's going to hang on, and Biwott has definitely become detached. And now it's just the four.
And it's interesting to note that when they come to the water stations, more often than not, Kipchoge has not been interested. He moves to the left-hand side of the road as he looks at it. Galen Rupp has always been taking a drink. So now we are down to four. Four into three doesn't go for the medals, but they look as though they are the men. Ethiopia with two of the representatives. Can they team up and defeat the might of Kipchoge, or can the lone American here in Galen Rupp, who's looked so comfortable and so composed during the race, outkick the African runners? It's shaping up as an intriguing and enthralling finish in the marathon.
Well, it's brilliant. And one by one, it's happened exactly as Eliud Kipchoge would have liked so far. And now, looking at the two Ethiopians, I think it's Faisa Lalisa who's looking the more positive. He's on Galen Rupp's shoulder, and a tiny little gap now with Bahanu, allowing a metre or so to grow. Might be nothing. That he might just prefer to run at the back of that group. He was the one who was beckoning for Eliud Kipchoge to start increasing the pace. Well, he's got his wish, and now he's got to hang on a little bit.
They're about 2 kilometres away, a little bit more than 2 kilometres away from coming out of this loop. So they're about to complete the third 10-kilometre loop, and then they will go alongside the water all the way towards the Museum of Tomorrow, and then that will bring them back down to Avenue Rio Branco for the long straight stretch, which is more than a couple of kilometres long at Presidente Vargas Avenue to the Sambadrome, which seems at the moment a long way away, and it's just getting to the stage now almost where four have become three.
Yes, and Lemmy Bahanu, who was motioning for the others to speed up, he was the one trying to boss proceedings, and he's the one now struggling. The winner of the Boston Marathon, 2:04:33 in Dubai, finishing behind a bearer, his compatriot who's already dropped out. He now finds himself in that unenviable position of watching a group edge further and further away from him. And even though this is way, way slower than he's already run this season, it is so, so difficult to get this back when it starts to go wrong. And what a performance this is at the moment, bearing in mind we've got the hardest, by far the hardest, 6 miles of the race still to come, as we watch Biwott and Korea struggling there with Solomon Mutai. They're the three who will
do everything they can to try and head back towards the leaders, but in the not-too-distant future, they're going to have Bahanu coming back to them. What a performance from Galen Rupp. This is only the second marathon he has ever run, and he's right up there with the second fastest man in history, tracking his every move right behind him. These could be the three medalists, but there's still over half an hour of running to go, and it's still possible that one of these three could run into a problem in the closing stages. But how good does Eliud Kipchoge look at the moment?
Well, it's only 3 kilometres ago that we had 10 runners within 4 seconds of the lead, and that has changed so dramatically now. That gap between third and fourth is more than 4 seconds. So it seems as though the medals might have been decided. It is Kipchoge of Kenya, Rupp of the United States, Lalisa of Ethiopia. Everyone at this moment would probably expect Eliud Kipchoge to win, with the possible exception of the two men behind him. At 31 years of age, he's been the dominant force in marathon running, having only lost once at the 42-kilometre distance. 2:03.05 was his time in London. He should have a kick finish, but Rupp and Lalisa will have something to say about that.
Well, the confidence that Eliud Kipchoge will have from the marathon record he's got, he has not run one single bad marathon. Even the marathon he didn't win, he finished second in Berlin in 2:04.05 back in 2013. He has been so consistent, and in terms of the times, this is what he's produced across his seven. 2:05.5, 2:04.05, 2:05 on the nose, 2:04.11, 2:04.42, 2:04 on the nose, and 2:03.05. That is an absolutely phenomenal series and sequence of marathon times. And there's a little smile on the face of Eliud Kipchoge. I'm sure it was. I think he was responding to the fact that he's got this unofficial peloton alongside him. It's a mixture of bikes and rather excited spectators who, at the pace he's running at the moment, will be out of breath in 50 metres time. I'm sure he had a smile there, and that tells you he is well within his comfort zone here, even though he's testing the two men trying to fight him for the gold medal.
And I think he's trying to wind it up here, and I think he's trying to break the two men behind him. Well, he broke Bahanu not that long ago. They're coming just onto a little uphill section, and they are about to leave the loop, as we said. So different scenery for the runners to look at, but the only thing that Galen Rupp wants to look at the moment is 2:06.80. That is the number on the back of Eliud Kipchoge. He doesn't want to be seeing 2:03.98, which is the number on the back of Lalisa. He is quite content to latch onto the back of the champion Kenyan, who again puts in another little surge and tries to drop them away, just as he has been able to do to this man. And look at the gap that has now multiplied so very quickly for Bahanu. And there's also the mental thing that happens when you realise that in all likelihood you are going to finish in fourth place unless he gets overtaken, and there's a possibility of that. But Bahanu is in the worst place in the marathon. You'd almost rather finish last than you would in fourth place in lots of ways.
I'd be amazed if he finishes in fourth. The wheels have come off, and they've come off spectacularly. Unlike the League Three, Galen Rupp is producing an absolutely brilliant performance here. And I think what's really helped him is the fact that they didn't start off on 2:07, 2:08 pace, because that would have taken him out of his comfort zone. At this kind of pace, he's running comfortably. And let's remind ourselves, when he ran 2:11 in LA, it was absolutely boiling. These conditions are far more conducive to distance running. Yes, it will be a little bit sticky. That's why so many of them have taken on so much liquid. But Galen Rupp is running brilliantly. And as we said earlier, when Great Britain's Callum Hawkins was leading, it is so important for young athletes, young up-and-coming athletes, who maybe at the moment are doing the 5 and the 10, and they think maybe one day they'll want to be a marathon runner. It's too easy to get despondent and say, there's no point in trying the marathon because I'm never going to beat the Kenyans and the Ethiopians. Well, Paula Radcliffe proved that wrong. Galen Rupp just looked over his shoulder. There might be a little indication that he's hurting, or maybe he just wanted to know whether they are away and clear in first, second and third, which they are. But Paula did it in the 90s and the early noughties. with hard work, with dedication, with application, it is possible for Western athletes to compete alongside the might of the East Africans. They're human beings, they're not machines, and if they can work hard, so can our athletes. And for that reason, as we watch Biwott beginning to reel in Bahanu, for that reason, I'm so pleased to see Galen Rupp up in the mix for the medals here, because it sends the right signal to Western-based distance runners that with the right amount of hard work, there is no reason you can't be in the mix for a major medal, come an Olympic Games or a World Championship.
Biwott and Mutai now only 15 metres or so behind Bahanu, who looks to have cracked completely. And they've got the advantage of running with each other and having a target, whereas Bahanu basically does not have a target up the road now. The leaders have disappeared on him. 15.03 was the last 5 kilometre split, and we're coming to the split now, 1:47.40. So they have gone 14.25 for that last 5K.
That is absolutely brutal. And I saw Galen Rupp glancing over his shoulder a little while ago. Eliud Kipchoge there just put his hands out in consternation. He wanted to reach for his individual drink, but had to settle for a bottle of water. And Rupp has discarded the hat again. That's the second time he's done that. He's looking for his own individual drink, which he manages to get. I think he's hurting. And with 14.22, no wonder. Now, the question for Galen Rupp, can he manage to hang on for another Olympic medal? Remember, he got the silver behind Mo Farah in 2012. He's searching for his own drink there. He's discarded his second cap. We saw him glancing over his shoulder a few hundred metres ago. He's hurting.
Well, I can tell you that the gap between third and fourth at the moment is 47 seconds. Bahanu has gone through, but he is joined and headed now. Mutai and Biwott go past him. They went through at the same time. So it is about 47 seconds between Rupp and these two men, who will still be harbouring some desire, well, a lot of desire, but some hope of taking the bronze medal. And look at the conversation going on between the two up the front.
Well, look at the acceleration as well from Eliud Kipchoge. I think he wasn't happy with the fact that Lalisa was right on his heels. He may have even clipped him a little bit. And Kipchoge was almost motioning him to say, well, hang on a minute, oh, there's Stanley Biwott. And Biwott's had to stop.
Wow.
Well, I thought he might be in the mix to catch Galen Rupp if Rupp began to tire. But Lalisa there, the gauntlet was laid down by Kipchoge, who said, listen, if you're going to run like that, you might as well run alongside me. I think this is Kipchoge's race. I know that's an early call with 20 minutes of running still to go. But look at how fresh his legs appear. And the Ethiopian is really having to work for his cadence. Wow. Eliud Kipchoge is turning this into an absolute masterclass.
Well, probably not a good idea to make him angry, because that's what he was a moment ago. And they might have just poked the bear there. And all of a sudden, Eliud Kipchoge says, I'm having no more of this. I'll go out and run my own race. And he takes a little glance over the shoulder. And the gap is around 15 to 20 metres and widening. And here's the incident that perhaps prompted it just around this time. And Kipchoge says, what are you doing there? What are you doing on my heels? There's no need to be doing that. Well, if you're going to do that, I'm going up the road.
Amazing exchange at the business end of a marathon. And this now is the most important 20 minutes in Eliud Kipchoge's career. He has achieved a great deal. World champion while still a teenager in 2003 in Paris, beating Elgar Rouge and Kenenisa Bekele to the 5,000-metre world title. Then came the bronze in the Olympics in 2004, and then the silver in 2008, missing out to Kenenisa Bekele, who did the double. But the Ethiopian has not become completely detached here. Lalisa, the bronze medalist from the World Championship in Daegu, he believes that he can reel this lead in of Eliud Kipchoge's. And that metaphoric elastic band hasn't snapped. And Rupp's still going okay in third place. But this is going to really hurt Galen Rupp. You were asking me earlier, how's he going to feel when the acceleration comes? Well, of course, he can run 14.20s in his sleep for 5,000 metres on the track. He probably does that during a rep session. But put 20 miles in his legs up until that stage and then begin asking the questions. And they're a little more difficult to answer. So Rupp is now going to be managing his own demons as he tries to hang on for what would be an incredible bronze medal.
Lalisa is just holding sight of Kipchoge at the moment, whereas Rupp, even though it seemed as though he was in sight of the second place getter, has lost contact. Now, there is a relative positioning of the men who are chasing Mutai and Baranu, who are now racing together. So at least they've got the advantage of having someone there. They might be able to do a couple of little turns for each other, and that can get you 1 or 2 seconds. But this man now appears to be going up the road. He was pretty careful there because it was a precarious turn on a slippery part of the course. We were down there this morning as we were leaving, and the heavy rain had fallen and left a lot of puddles on that area. And they're about to head back into the town area. Have a look at Rupp's viewpoint, and he can see the man a long way up the road, and it's going to be a mighty performance for him to even think about getting the silver medal. At the moment, what he needs to do is concentrate his efforts into running his own race and standing on the podium.
Yes, and just getting a glimpse of Rupp on the previous shot, you could tell how careful Lalisa was there as he went round that corner. He's running okay here. His cadence still seems quite positive, but he will be really, really hurting. And I wonder if there's any slip-up in his momentum at all. There he's glancing round again because he's trying to see how close Baranu and Solomon Mutai are behind him. In fourth and fifth, it looked as though it might be Stanley Piwott who was closing the gap. But if there's any problem for Rupp in the last 15 minutes, the Ugandan Solomon Mutai might be in a position to strike. So we've got all sorts of questions going on here. Kipchoge looks good. He looks strong. Faisa Lalisa is desperately trying to keep him in his sight line. And the flame will come down on these games later on this evening when the winner of this one will have that wonderful honour of being awarded their gold medal as part of the closing ceremony. This is Kipchoge's to lose here. He just needs to keep it going. But what's happening in the battle for silver and bronze? Can Rupp keep it going and produce America's first medal for 40 years? Can Lalisa finish off a great race and manage to stay on the podium?
And so they're about to head on to Avenue Presidente Vargas, and that will be the main home straight before they turn and sprint into the Sambadrome. It is a long straight run, and it's going to be a run where the runners will be able to keep visual contact with each other. Rupp is able to do that with Lalisa at the moment. The gap would have to be around 50 metres, allowing for the camera angle. But Kipchoge looking strong and disappearing up the road. 2680 is the number that they have been looking at now for the last few kilometres. 2398 Lalisa, 3097 Rupp. They look to be the medals in that order. Anything, of course, can happen in the last few kilometres. We've still, remember, got around 4.5 kilometres to go, but at the moment, it looks as though the dominant force in marathon running, the man who is the favourite coming in here, Eliud Kipchoge, is going to be standing on the top step of the victory dais. Another little race going on between these three.
Well, and this is fascinating because it's Gurme Gebre Selassie, the reigning world champion, who suddenly recaptured some momentum. So he's gone past Lemmy Baranu, and it looked as though Baranu had recovered his momentum. So you've got Baranu running with Mutai, and all of a sudden, Gurme Gebre Selassie looks as though his legs are full of it here.
He's sprinting.
So that means if there's any problem for Rupp, or for Lalisa in second place, there is still enough time with about 14 or 15 minutes of running to go. There is still enough time for the Eritrean to produce his nation's second Olympic medal. Remember, they've only won one, and that was a bronze with Zerzene Tadese in the 10,000 metres in 2004. So there's all sorts going on behind this man.
They are coming up to the Museum of Tomorrow, where they will run a little loop down beside the building, and then they will come back around the other side of the building, and then they'll be heading back into the centre of Rio de Janeiro. The weather is starting to clear after it was overcast skies and plenty of precipitation early before the race. But now, just as Eliud Kipchoge is heading off into the sunrise, another battle may be emerging, maybe, Gebre Selassie can do what we thought was impossible when we saw him stopping just a few kilometres ago.
Well, there could be real drama in these closing stages. Eliud Kipchoge, twice the Olympic medalist, but not the colour he wanted on the track. This is his bold bid to finally get Olympic glory. And there are the three medalists. And if anything, Galen Rupp may just possibly be closing the gap on the Ethiopian in second place.
I think you're right.
Wow. So he's aiming to become the first American-born athlete to pick up a medal since Frank Shorter 40 years ago. Meb emigrated to the States, so we have had an American silver medalist in 2004. And what a performance this would be for Galen Rupp to replicate his silver from the 10,000 metres. Now, there's the gap. We should expect the tall figure of Galen Rupp to appear in shot. I mean, the angles sometimes do foreshorten it. Now he's coming round the corner. That gap looks bridgeable to me. If there is any let-up from Faisal Alisa, then Galen Rupp looks as though he's in a position to pounce. And I think he is thinking about silver. He's not worrying about whether he's going to hang on for the bronze. He's looking over his shoulder just to make sure, as we return our view from behind Eliud Kipchoge. The athlete in fourth is Gurmay Gebre Selassie. We're still waiting to see how far behind Galen Rupp he is. But how good to see the crowds beginning to turn out in force here. And when they head back towards the finish, it should be, on the evidence of what we're seeing here, a glorious finish and a glorious moment for Eliud Kipchoge. He looks full of running. There's no sign of fatigue in his legs whatsoever. He has been the world's outstanding performer over the marathon distance for the last 3 years, and that looks to be continuing here on the most important occasion of his career.
And this man can't afford to be doing too much looking in the rear vision mirror. He has to run his own race, maybe focus his efforts if he can see Kipchoge rather than the man who's behind him. The gap between them was about 50 metres. It looks a little less than that now. Rupp's going to have to produce something special because they've only got 3.1 kilometres to the finish. So he is going to have to produce that kick finish that we've seen from the American on the track. It looks as though he should be okay for the bronze medal. We haven't seen any sign of Gebre Selassie for a little while now, but the last time we saw him, he was positively sprinting after looking as though he was out of the race. And here he is now. So we'll get a relative position. Well, he's just coming up on the other side of the Museum of Tomorrow. So Rupp is going to be pretty comfortable, you would think. It's almost an impossible task for Gebre Selassie to be able to make up that amount of ground. Or is he coming down? He's actually coming down the side where he's leaving the Museum of Tomorrow. So there's still some little hope, but that spring that he had in his step when he got past the other two runners a little while ago, not quite there. And he's still going to find himself a long way distant from the bronze medalist in waiting, Galen Rupp, but the gold medalist in waiting is well and truly up the road. Eliud Kipchoge getting closer to the Olympic Championship as he enters the city in Rio de Janeiro.
It would take a real problem, I think, now for Galen Rupp to not finish on the podium. Gebre Selassie's clearly found a little bit of a second wind, but this race has, from the start, been about one man. At the beginning, it was his reputation. It was the great performances he's produced over the last three seasons. A man who in seven marathons, and this being his eighth, has yet to run a bad one. Every athlete has one, no matter how good you are, no matter how fast you are, but it's yet to happen for Eliud Kipchoge. Round the cones, a little bit awkward there, interrupting his rhythm. No sign of cramp, which is good. And he also has no sign of Faisal Alisa. And now he'll glance to his right hand side, even if he doesn't look properly. That's the gap from first to second, and what a welcome sight that will be from the perspective of Eliud Kipchoge. And the same will happen now once the tiny powerhouse from Ethiopia rounds these very tight cones. He will get a glimpse of how close Galen Rupp is to him. So that's the view from second back to third. And in a moment, Galen Rupp will probably be reassured. He might be surprised that it's Gebre Selassie who's behind him, because he'd been spat out the back quite a while ago. And Rupp now looks up and he struggles a little bit there to regain his momentum. No such issues for Eliud Kipchoge, and I wonder whether he's now thinking about the fact that he's so close to becoming an Olympic champion after so many years of going so close on the track. This could well be his day of destiny here in Rio.
And so he begins the long straight stretch down Avenue Presidente Vargas, which is around 2 kilometres long, and then one more turn left into the famous Sambadrome. And Lalisa now having a good look behind him. He's starting to feel the strain, and you can hardly blame him for that. And let's have a look for the marks as they go through 40 kilometres, 2:02.24 for Kipchoge. We'll get the official gap between himself and Lalisa in a moment. Lalisa, though, keeping an eye on Galen Rupp and keeping an eye on what the gap is between the silver medal position and the bronze medal position. There is Gebrselassie. He can't see Rupp, hasn't got physical contact with him or eye contact with him, and it seems as though 2 kilometres to go, that's probably going to be a little bit too much. Still waiting on the second runner to cross the line. There he goes at 36 seconds now. The gap between himself and Rupp is going to be interesting, because he was having a very good look around. It's 12 seconds between silver and bronze, and then we'll keep an eye on the time for Gebrselassie and see if there is any hope of another runner making his way up into the medals. He is yet to go through, but this man is heading for glory.
Look at the composure, the concentration and the focus. A beautifully economical looking runner. There's no wasted motion up or down. It's the action of a man who was born to run, first of all on the track over 5,000 metres and now on the roads. And he said himself, this is where I feel happiest, this is my distance, this is me. And it looks like that will be the case here today. The second half of this race will have been run much, much quicker than he did in the first. He ran the first half in 65:55, and I think Lalisa's going to struggle here. I would put Galen Rupp down as favourite to go into the silver medal position. He's got a massive margin there from third to fourth, Galen Rupp. So he's got that comfort blanket, but I think he wants the gold. And Gebrselassie, I wonder whether he's getting that information that he is so far behind Galen Rupp in that battle for bronze. But Lalisa, in terms of the body language, the cameras are showing us, he keeps looking over his shoulder, and 12 seconds could very quickly evaporate.
And here are the men who are going to finish outside of the medals. Simbu of Tanzania has got himself up into fifth place, so he's run a really good race. He was 12th after 30 kilometres and has got himself up to fifth. And Mutai is now in sixth place. Rupp, with the man ahead of him, in the silver medal position, in his sights. There's not long to go, but he's got visual contact and he's got a target to pick off. And Lalisa has been worried for a little while now. He's had a couple of good looks in the rear vision mirror.
I think Rupp's got this. He's got all the momentum and he can see him up ahead. Lalisa has nothing to focus on because Kipchoge is gone. He's in a class of his own, and he is now just moments away from fulfilling a lifetime's ambition, and he still looks so strong and so full of running. It will be great to see his split for the second half of the race.
That split there is interesting. Rupp has only been able to take 1 second off Lalisa since they went through the 40 kilometre mark, so he's taken 1 second off him in 1.1 kilometres. It looked as though the gap was closing, but time-wise it is now back to 12 seconds, so it's exactly where it was at 40k.
Has he got the acceleration in the closing stages? Does he want it enough? There's Lalisa. It's now 9 seconds, 10 seconds. I think this one could go all the way to a big sprint. Can he find something in the last kilometre and secure a second Olympic silver medal? He finished on the podium behind Mo in London, but this arguably would be more of a surprise medal in only his second race over the marathon distance. It's been an absolutely brilliant performance from Galen Rupp in third. Lalisa's run the race of his life. He's trying to upgrade the bronze medal he got in the World Championships back in Daegu. But Eliud Kipchoge now, he's pulling further and further away from Lelisa, and Rupp is just, well, it keeps flicking from 8, 9, 10 seconds. Eliud Kipchoge now, almost a minute clear. He has destroyed this field with an absolutely blistering acceleration of pace. 14.22 for that 5 kilometre, and that's what did the damage. And he's now beginning to soak up the applause of the crowd. He knows, he must know surely now, he's going to be the Olympic champion as he edges towards the finish. And he's...
So he's won Hamburg, he's won Rotterdam, Chicago, London, Berlin, and then London again. And now he's heading for glory in Rio.
This is it. There's nothing standing between Eliud Kipchoge and the moment he's dreamed of for so many years. It's a grimace, but I think it's a smile as well. Twice he was denied the Olympic gold medal in Athens on the track and in Beijing, as Rupp desperately tries to close the gap on Lelisa. Kipchoge looks round, but there's no one in sight because he's been in a class of his own here today. He has yet to run a bad marathon. This is where he feels at home, on the roads rather than on the track. But he's still got the speed that took him to the Olympic podium twice. But it didn't take him on top. This time, it's a glorious finish for Eliud Kipchoge. It's a guard of honour on both sides of the run-in for home. He's still sprinting, still accelerating. And how he would have dreamed of this moment for so many years. Eliud Kipchoge is the Olympic marathon champion, and he has destroyed the field with brilliant acceleration. He will be acclaimed one of the famous Olympic champions. Finally, he has the gold, and look at what it means to him. His whole career has been building up to this moment, and it has finally produced the gold medal. Lelisa is a spent force in second. He's glancing over his shoulder. Rupp is doing everything he can to close the gap, but now Lelisa can celebrate. He adds his name to a rich list of Ethiopian marathon medalists, not to be the gold, but what a great finish from him. We could tell he was hurting, we could tell he was struggling, but he's managed to withhold the advance of Galen Rupp. They're both absolutely exhausted. Lelisa glancing over his shoulder again and again and again. He doesn't want to have to sprint in the last 20 metres. Rupp is jogging home. What an amazing performance from him in only his second marathon. But it's silver for Faisa Lelisa, upgrading his bronze from the World Championships in Daegu. Second this time. And what a moment for Galen Rupp in only his second marathon. In this most brutal of distances, the American is coming home for a place on the Olympic podium. Lelisa celebrates. He'll wait for the rest of his teammates. Galen Rupp, Olympic silver on the track in London, is the marathon bronze medalist in an event in which he is still a total novice, but not anymore. He's the Olympic bronze medalist. What a performance! And you could argue that's even better than the silver he produced behind Mo on the track. And heartache for Gebre Selassie, world champion last year. This time, it's going to be fourth. He had a little wobble halfway through the race, and that cost him because he still looks full of running here. But he's come back to his best performance a little bit too late. The Eritrean unable to add another medal to that nation's collection after Zerzanay Tadese's bronze in Athens 12 years ago. Fourth this time for Gurmay Gebre Selassie, the reigning world champion. What a race.
Extraordinary at the finish, and a deserving champion. In fact, three deserving medalists. Lelisa had to battle against his mind, battle against his body over the last couple of kilometres. Rupp's performance in just his second marathon, extraordinary. And let's pay tribute to the men as they come over the line. Gebre Selassie in fourth place. And Simbu, Alphonse Simbu of Tanzania, has come from 12th at the 30-kilometre mark to finish in fifth place in 2:11.15. And a mighty performance too by Jared Ward, who has dropped off and just had to keep gutsing it out, and he's done that. to sixth place in 2:11.30. Next man across the line is the man from Switzerland who actually led them out of the Sambadrome, and he's in seventh place when they come back in. Tedesse Abraham, 2:11.42. Mutai of Uganda just behind him in 2:11.49. And then the Brit, Callum Hawkins, who finishes with a top 10 finish in the marathon at 2:11.52. There is the champion. He can now be ranked up with the greats of the marathon after what he has been able to do over the last couple of years, and he takes away the most coveted title of them all.
The second half of the race was absolutely brutal. The Canadian coming home to complete the top 10. Brilliant performance from Callum Hawkins. Still getting to grips with this distance. That's a cracking run from him. But Kipchoge was so fast in the second half of the race, and absolutely nobody could live with him. All credit to the two other medalists. Lalisa, how many times did Lalisa look over his shoulder in the last couple of kilometres? It really seemed as though Rupp was going to catch him at one stage.
Well, the splits are the first half 1:05.55, and then they've run home the second half in 1:02.49.
That is absolutely brutal to run the second half of the race, or Kipchoge anyway, in under 63 minutes. That's what did the damage.
Eric Gillis of Canada has landed the 10th spot, rounded out the top 10 at 2:12.29. We've had Nguye of the Netherlands come in 11th. We've had Gala of Djibouti come in 12th in 2:13.04. And he has run a personal best. Personal best, by the way, for Rupp, understandably. Ward's run a personal best. And also Gala running a personal best of the men who have finished the marathon so far. But he had a bit of a smile on his face. When you think back, possibly the decisive move of the race might have been the doing of the man who finished in the silver medal position, Lalisa, when he was getting too close to Kipchoge's heels. And Kipchoge all of a sudden decided that he was going to change the race there, because he almost said you could read his mind. He didn't want to be involved in any of that when there were just two of them out on the road, and he made the move there that was never ever counted.
Yes, it almost lit the fire within Eliud Kipchoge. He and Lalisa were clear and away at the front of the field, but he definitely felt as though the Ethiopian was running too close to him. Moen was just having a little wave as he came across the line there inside the top 20. Some very, very tired men here. Oh, how nice is that? On the phone, maybe to his wife. And I think, bearing in mind he's so new to marathon running, I think that outranks his silver on the track over 10,000 metres in London.
Another personal best from Pedra of Ecuador, who's come in 18th place at 2:14.12. As the runners continue to file over the line, and they've got their own little battles going on. If you can't win a medal, then a personal best is about what you're aiming for at these Olympic Games. There's the silver medalist. He really did have a battle on his hands. At times it looked as though Rupp was going to get to him. He never really looked as though he was going to get Kipchoge in the last few kilometres after that incident that we were talking about. But it is Kenya, Ethiopia, the United States of America to stand on the dais, and they will do so tonight at the closing ceremony. What a stage to receive their medals as Rio brings down the curtain on these Olympic Games. And the runners collapsing over the line. You can get to that line and then one stride further after that, and there is nothing in reserve, nothing left in your body, nothing left to give. This man, in contrast, looked as though he could have almost done a lap of honour.
Inside 63 minutes for the second half of the race, and he still looked like there was more in the tank had he needed it. He won by 1:10, and he did all the damage in the closing stages. And that's one of the Australians, Adams, coming across.
Yeah, nearly face planting on the line. It was a bit slippery down there for Liam Adams, I should say.
Pollock of Ireland, tired figure. And here's Meb bringing his journey to an end here and surely there won't be another instalment of Olympic drama for him.
Well, you want to bet?
Wow. What a way to finish your Olympic career, having to do a couple of press-ups before you get to the finish line. He was lucky he wasn't injured there.
Well, let's hope he's not injured. The way that he's been able to do that, I think he's taken it in good spirit. Half across the line, half not. A bit like Sean O'Miller the other night in the 400.
And I wonder what embrace Meb will have for his compatriot Galen Rupp when he finds out that after he got the silver in Athens, his compatriot has produced an absolutely brilliant moment for a bronze medal in only his second race at the distance.
And just confirming the number of people and some of the big names that are not going to cross the finish line. Biwott of Kenya is a non-finisher. He got through 30 kilometres. In fact, he got through 35 kilometres and then was forced to retire from the race. Bakili was another one of the big names who didn't get there. Abera, also a retirement. Tavelde of Great Britain, also out. And the first one to go out was Maiucci, the Italian, who was fancied because he'd had a good finish at the World Championships. He'd finished in eighth place there, but he was the first one to go out.
Cuban Perez finishing with a banner. And there's Michael Shelley of Australia, the Commonwealth champion from Glasgow. It's been a tough day for him, although he's still come home inside 2:20. And there was a little embrace there. I was just watching the Ukrainian come across the line. There was an embrace there between Galen Rupp and Meb, the two American Olympic medalists, one from Athens and one from Rio. What a story for Galen Rupp. Absolutely amazing. And there'll be a few big race promoters, especially those who've got Boston and New York and Chicago. Well, they'd absolutely love to get Galen Rupp in their field if it turns out that he decides that he's going to shift his focus away from the 10,000 on the track. He'll get some very handsome offers to have a crack at a couple of big city races in America.
And just to recognise the personal bests of some of these runners as they go across the line, Ernesto Zamora of Uruguay, 33 years of age, has run a lifetime best of 2:18.36. Dos Santos, the Brazilian, who was there and thereabouts for quite some way, crosses the line in 2:19.09, around 10 and a half minutes behind our winner. And look at the bodies just making it to the line. And good sportsmanship and camaraderie from the other runners getting up there and helping him up. We've talked about the brotherhood that exists between the marathon runners and the decathletes, and there's a good illustration of it there. Just a bit of concern as that runner went over the line, and I think essentially he's just saying, leave me alone, I'll be fine, but I've given all I've got.
It's a great, great example of men pushing themselves to the very limit of their physical capabilities, and in some cases beyond it as well. You have to admire that ability to force the body into places it doesn't want to go. Now, is he chatting to someone, having a selfie, or just listening to some music?
Probably a bit of all of those. That was the silver medalist, Lalisa, we just saw. As the field continues to file across the line, we've had now 67 runners have come across the line. The 68th is El Hissouf of Morocco, who crosses in 2:20.29. And just a little sprint for the line as well. Always wanting to touch off the man that you're running the last couple of kilometres with.
What a nice embrace that is between the two men. There is huge respect. When you cross the finish line of a marathon, the first thing you do, apart from gasp for breath, is shake the hand of the man or woman next to you, because you've both been on the same journey. You've done it in almost exactly the same time, and you both know exactly how the other one's feeling.
We just saw a good example of the rubber legs as the runners came over the line, but legs of steel for this man and a smile to match. But he too, the emotion of the moment caught him as he went across the line. He looked so good and so positive for so long, but just after the realization set in, he too found himself collapsing. Lalisa doing Ethiopia proud, and Galen Rupp with thanks to up above for his performance as he crosses the line in third place. Another one of the Brazilian runners coming home, Da Silva. He'll be in a tick over 2:21. In fact, it'll be 2:22.05, so a minute or so behind the man in front of him.
And look how much time Kiprop lost at the finish. He was right up there, probably towards the 30K mark, but it unraveled a little bit for him.
And they've had to call for a photo after 26 miles and 385 yards. They've had to call for a photo to separate Ruiz and Kiprop. And Ruiz has been given the time of 2:22.09, and he might have just touched out Kiprop.
That's great. Going for it. They've been given the same time, but he's got it on the dip on the line. 26.2 miles, and you do it with a dip as you head over to the finish line. Some of these men are absolutely broken. They've left it all out on the streets of Rio. But what an incredible moment it will be for Lalisa, for Rupp. There is Lalisa. Hopefully he'll be smiling. He looks
yes.
a bit serious.
Oh, I'm sure he will be by the time tonight comes around. And Galen Rupp was trying to pick out someone in the crowd there to share it with. The Australians in Adams and Shelley sharing their races.
And I wonder if Mo Farah was here watching somewhere, having done his double-double. They're such close friends.
Yeah, well, they showed that in that incident in the 10,000 when it was actually Galen Rupp who brought Mo down. And he dropped back. And there's another runner almost slipping as they go over the line. Yes, Rupp dropped back to find out whether Mo was okay. Revived memories of a very famous incident that we talked about at the time between John Landy and Ron Clark down in Australia, which is one of the most famous incidents in Australian running, where Landy stopped himself in a race and went back after Ron Clark fell to see whether he was okay. And it was shades of that between the two great friends and the great training rivals in the 10K, Rupp and Mo Farah, who last night did the double-double at the stadium.
Yeah, I'm sure he'll be giving him a massive hug as and when he does see him. And there'll be some really good choices now for Galen Rupp as to whether he leaves the 10,000. Imagine if he'd got a medal in both. Well, maybe that was being a little greedy. He did, but of course his 10,000 came 4 years ago rather than here in Rio. That was the Mongolian Batochir. Tends to run quite well in the big championships.
And we just saw one of the Chinese go across the line in Duo Buji. The Chinese runners were up the front of the race for a while, but he has finished in 91st place, 2:24.22. But it's just finishing in itself is an achievement at the Olympic Games. And these testing conditions, yes, better than blazing sunlight that the women had a week ago, but it's still a test when you're running against the best in the world. Any time that you run 42.195 kilometres is a test, but in this company, even more so. And there's a puppy getting into the action. At least he didn't dive out under anyone's feet in the last little bit. That would have been about the last thing you would have needed.
Imagine that in the last 20 yards of running over 26 miles. Wow. Well, we were treated to some great sights around the city, even though it is a little bit misty and a little bit murky here in Rio. What an intriguing race. There was so much attention on Eliud Kipchoge, and he sat and he waited and he waited, and when he went, it was a really definitive move, and absolutely nobody could stop him finally becoming the Olympic champion after bronze and silver medals in Athens and Beijing. What a story.
And we've just had the 100th man across the line in Ho Chi Minh of Chinese Taipei in a time of 2:26. It has been a remarkable story, all under the gaze of Cristo Redentor, Christ the Redeemer, sitting high above Rio de Janeiro. Clahissi, the Irishman, comes in, finishing just outside that 100th placing. He gets the time of 2:26.34. They'll sleep well tonight, apart from all the aches and pains. How long does it take you to recover from something like this? How long does the body take to recover?
I think it depends. I mean, I've never run it at the level that these guys have performed at, so on some ways you could argue that the fitter you are, the quicker you get over it, but their legs will be really, really feeling it for a couple of weeks. But what a moment for Eliud Kipchoge. And I think there were tears.
Yeah, it did hit him there. The emotion of the moment and probably the physical strain all combined gives you that reaction. And such a cool, calm, collected character all the way through the race. And then the fact that it dawned on him that he was the Olympic champion, all of a sudden that realisation overtook him. And it was the only thing to overtake him. None of his opponents could do that.
And to go back to answering your question, the worst thing is walking downstairs, because you're putting pressure, you're replicating that running motion, and it's very, very painful. I know people who slide down the stairs on their bum for a couple of days after they've run a marathon.
We head up to 2.5 hours after the winner did it in 2 hours, 8 minutes and 44 seconds. The Sambadrome. This purpose-built facility, it is a permanent facility there. And it is where Carnival is held in Rio. So it's seen all sorts of sights and sounds over the years. As we look down on the city on this cloudy and overcast day, with the closing ceremony to come a little bit later on. And there's the man who beat all bar one to the line, Faiza Lalisa, the 26-year-old from Ethiopia, who's run a personal best of 2:04.52, but we knew it wasn't going to be a fast race early on, but it was certainly fast in the second half, with that 1:02.49 second half negative splitting after a 1:05.55.
There's Callum's brother, Derek. It's been a tough day for him. I'm sure when he recovers, he'll be delighted for his younger brother, who's come home with a top 10 finish, ninth for Callum, 2:11.52. The two brothers proudly flying the flag for Great Britain, but that's been a really, really tough day for Hawkins Senior. And there they are having a little embrace.
And they didn't cross the line together, the brothers, unlike the sisters in the women's marathon, and that attracted a fair bit of attention around the world, including from their home nation, when they decided to hold hands and run across the line. There were some rather surprising comments, I thought, about that. I'm not sure that they would have engineered their places to finish together. Maybe they just found themselves in a very similar place, but everyone has their own viewpoint on that. But from my point of view, some of the comments seemed a little bit harsh. I think you should be applauding people if they can finish a marathon under any circumstances.
I agree. Even for these guys coming home in 2:30 and beyond, they have worked so hard for the right to represent their country on the biggest marathon in the world that only happens once every 4 years. And if you have a bad race and it all begins to unravel, but you still have the heart and the courage to make it to the finish line, who is anybody else watching to tell you what you should do as you cross that line? If you want to join hands with a twin sister, if you want to wave, if you want to cry, it's your prerogative, it's your race, and you've earned the right to finish it however you see fit. Because if you've run 26.2 miles, even if it's taken you 3 or 4 hours, you have the right to finish that race as exactly as you see fit. And it's emotional.
Yeah,
these guys are broken. They've completed the Olympic marathon, and they're miles away from the medals. Maybe they were never going to be in with a shout of a medal, but for them, the pinnacle was qualifying, was having the right to stand on that start line and call themselves an Olympic marathon runner. So I think for anybody to question how the athletes at the tail end of the field finish is very, very harsh.
We've now had 124 athletes through, and the retirement numbers that we mentioned before about 14 retirements as I make it. And there's a nice picture of the Colombians. And look at the man from Iran who, by the look of it, is cramped up in his hamstring just near the line. And he is going to somehow find the line.
Crawling across the finish line.
He still hasn't quite made it.
Oh my gosh. What an image and what a moment. There was absolutely nothing left. And again, if someone wants to criticise that, well, that's a hard heart, isn't it? He was determined to get over the line without being helped.
That's Mohammad Jafar Moradi of Iran. His PB for the distance is 2:17. He's about 14 minutes outside of that as we continue to look back at the images. And there's a contrast from what we saw from Kipchoge. Sign of delight from the silver medalist and a sign of a great achievement from the bronze medalist, the 30-year-old from America.
Incredible performance from Rupp.
Yeah.
Incredible.
2:10.05 for Rupp. 2:08.44 the winner, and that man recording 2:09.54. And as we said, we just saw a shot of the famous Maracanã a little while ago, and that is where they will receive their medals. Those three, they know what it took. They've beaten the best from around the world in the greatest marathon championship of them all, the Olympic marathon, and victory going to the 31-year-old from Kenya. So 31-year-old wins, 26-year-old runs second, a 30-year-old runs third. And don't forget Gebrselassie, who stopped at one stage of the race, 20 years of age, has got himself back in. And he finishes in what a lot of people describe as the worst place in the marathon, 2:11.04, but still a great achievement nonetheless. But he will be the first man outside of the medals, and that is always tough. Great sense of relief once you've got this job over and done with. They've been preparing for a long, long time, a lifetime in many cases. As the runners continue to file in, we've got 129 of them across the line, and still it's going to be a long, long journey as they turn off Avenue Presidente Vargas and do the left-hand turn down to the welcome site of the Sambadrome. And we've already seen what that last few hundred metres can do to some athletes. We've seen athletes slipping over. We've seen athletes cramping up. And sometimes, even though it's only a few hundred metres after you've run 42 kilometres or thereabouts, it seems like that finish line is never going to come towards you.
And the Mongolian, who was 15th in the Seoul Marathon earlier this year, he leads the Korean Son, who's going through some turmoil in the last couple of hundred metres. Both of them still running, no sign of cramp just yet, no repetition of the crawling across the finish line. But that straight must seem a very, very long way when you come round that corner, because I was surprised how long it was when Kipchoge came round the final bend. Oh, and this is even worse. This is Bruno, the Argentinian.
Well, you can see the cramp in his leg. And isn't that great that one of the runners is going to stay with him there and try and get him home? Ayala just sticking with him and saying, come on, hang with me, we'll get you there. We'll get you over the line.
Look at how he's having to run.
Yeah.
He's doing the sideways warm-up because he can't run front on. That's absolutely amazing. He's doing the side on where you warm up the outside of your legs, your glutes and your hips, because he can't turn and run front on to the finish because he'd cramp up again. Surely he's not going to come down the home straight sideways, is he?
It might take him a long time to do it, but he's determined to get there by the look of it, as are these men. It's taken them an eternity to get down this finishing straight, but they do in more than 2.5 hours. I'll give you their official times. It was Savin Ravdan of Mongolia in 2:36.14 and Son of Korea in 2:36.24. 21, and still this battle to get to the line goes on.
Well, he's a really good 1500 meter runner, this guy. I suspect maybe he just failed to qualify for the Argentinian team, or realized that was going to be the case, so he decided that he'd have a crack at the marathon. Federico Bruno, he's run 3:38 for the 1500 and was sixth in the Pan American Games last year, and maybe found the step up to the marathon just a little bit too much in terms of the distance. It will certainly be, he hasn't even come into sight yet, it will certainly be one of the most memorable ways in which to finish a marathon, but he's getting the job done.
Well, we've seen the Iranian crawl across the line. We've seen Meb, who came towards the line and slipped and then did a push-up while he was halfway straddled across the line. So we've seen various ways of finishing the 26 miles and 385 yards. That distance only became standardised after a few Olympic Games, by the way. It was round about the 40-kilometre mark, not an exact distance. They actually calculated the distance between the appropriate places to start and finish back in the old days, the start of the modern Olympic Games. So, again, the man is there waiting for him, and he's going to wait for him, Ayala, that is Dulles Ayala of Paraguay, and he's going to do his best to get his mate home.
How nice is that? A Paraguayan and an Argentinian as Ribas finishes. This is the walking wounded. It really is. Ribas edging towards the finish. And this is still, these guys are clocking. They're only just outside 6 minute mile pace. So it may look as though they're on another league to the performance we've seen from Eliud Kipchoge. And they are. But hardly anybody in a major city marathon would be able to run this fast. They'd be way up towards the front of the field.
And now we've just gone past the half-hour mark since the win across the line. And you can see the carnage that it's caused. Costa Blanco of Panama is going to be the next man to come in. Let's have a look for his personal best time. He's gone at 2:15, so he's no slouch. He's run 2:15 this year, and look at the condition he's in as he gets to the line. The man just about to cross the line now.
So the Panamanian limping his way home, but he is completing the 2016 Rio Olympic Marathon. Just a few strides to go. The Paraguayan has moved ahead of the Argentinian. We're getting towards the tail end of the field, and he's done it. There's absolutely nothing left, but he's made it just over, what, half an hour behind.
And there's only six men left on the course now. Make that five.
What a sporting gesture, turning to wait to see his Argentinian rival. And will Bruno turn head on for the finish, or will he come across the line sideways?
I think he might take it all the way down sideways, and someone's handed him the Argentinian flag as well. So he is going to be the fifth last man to finish, and he's going to do it in unconventional fashion. But the thing is, he got there, and he did so with the help of a man that he now has a bond with in Dulles Ayala from Paraguay. Who knows, possibly they'd never met each other. That thing happened at the track the other day when two athletes got themselves involved in a skirmish. And here's the way he skipped across the line. Not much joy in that skipping though, just necessity.
But it shows you how determined he was to get to the finish and complete the race.
Yeah.
It might not have been orthodox, and in fact, I've never seen anybody finish a marathon like that ever at any standard.
And this was more than half an hour ago. Eliud Kipchoge taking the Olympic championship. We've only got four men out on the course, and one of them was up in the race for a long time, and that is Wesley Carrera of Kenya. Now, he has yet to finish. We don't know whether he's going to finish, but he certainly hasn't stopped from what we can tell from the timing. We have Shim of Korea. Takazaki is also out there. And Abu Drace of Jordan is yet to finish as well. So they are the only four men out on the course. But there's the man who beat all comers, and he was expected to. And here is Shim Jong-sub of Korea, the 25-year-old. Now, he too is a pretty handy runner. He's gone 2:13 and a half for the marathon, and today he's going to come in with a time well and truly over that. But we talked about it during the race. Sometimes it's just not your day. There's a couple of the other runners. No sign of Wesley Career yet, but they look as though they are the last men because the motorcyclists are rounding them up and keeping the spectators away from them.
Eliud Kipchoge will never tire of watching these images back. A really popular figure in Kenya and all across the Rift Valley. They'll be delighted that they have once again regained the Olympic title after Sammy Wanjiru won in 08. It then crossed the border to their neighbours Uganda for 2012. But they're back on top now, where they so often are and where they believe they belong.
138th place is going to go to this man. And it will do so in a time of 2 hours, 42 minutes and 42 seconds. So it appears as though we might have lost Wesley Career in dispatches somewhere. Haven't seen any sign of him unless he's further back down and they've assigned some more detail to him to get him home. But it's Takazaki of Cambodia, who's 39 years of age, this man in front. He's a 2.5 hour marathon runner. So he's outside of that, but he is determined that he's going to get to the line and he's going to sprint as hard as he can.
Wow, he's clearly not fancying finishing last here. He keeps looking over his shoulder. It's the man from Jordan who's trying to follow him home, and he's pulling away from him here.
Yeah, he was born in Japan, this man, and he gained Cambodian citizenship back in October 2011 with the hope of representing his new nation at the Games in London. And he had then been announced to represent Cambodia in the marathon at the 2012 Olympic Games. Unfortunately, he had that taken away from him because the IAAF ruled that he wasn't eligible to represent Cambodia, as an athlete must have at least 1 year of citizenship before being able to compete at the Olympic Games. So he was thinking that this moment was going to happen 4 years ago. It must have seemed like a very long wait to get to Rio de Janeiro. He does very good cat impersonations, this man. I thought you probably should know that. He actually made his name in Japan as a comedian. Well, he's finding nothing funny about the last 300 metres here.
How do you work out that you can do impressions of a cat? Quite incredible.
And the gates are closed behind them. So the last of the runners are coming to the line now. And we have now officially been notified that Wesley Career of Kenya is a non-finisher. The sprint to the line for the last two men, and Tarazaki is absolutely intent that he is not going to be the last man to the line. He's looking around like the silver medalist did in the last couple of kilometres. And the crowd at the Sambadrome will welcome both of these men home. Metcal Abu Drace, 32 years of age, from Jordan. He ran in London. He finished 56th there, and he was actually fasting as he was coming up to his preparation during the Games. But he's reversed that decision, and he's going to finish, and that's all that matters to him. So we go from the glory of Eliud Kipchoge at the head of the field to the last two men to finish. Kuniaki Takazaki of Cambodia is second last across the line. Yes, says the 39-year-old. And the last man to complete the course, Metcal Abu Drace of Jordan, completes the field in 140th and last place in the marathon in Rio. So they're all home. All of those that are going to finish have finished. and we have round about 15 who have succumbed to this race of attrition. And have a look at that. He's almost trying to get the Mexican wave going.
Great atmosphere from the crowd. He's got too much energy left, surely.
He'll be doing an impromptu stand-up performance any minute. We know he's a comedian. He'll probably grab the microphone and start cracking some gags. Imagine doing that after nearly 26 and a half miles.
Well, he clearly had a dream to become an Olympic athlete and an Olympic marathon runner. And that is a dream fulfilled. Even though it may have taken him 2 3/4 hours, he's done it. Oh, and now he's asking for a bottle of water.
And they probably took his photo almost as much as they did Eliud Kipchoge at the top of the race.
The men's marathon will start with Galen Rupp being called up to receive his bronze medal. Well, he must be a delighted man. He's been on an Olympic podium before. The USA cross-country star who took silver in the 10,000 meter at the London Games earned marathon bronze in only his second time ever running that distance. 2 hours, 10 minutes and 5 seconds. And he's congratulated by the president of the International Olympic Committee, former Olympic gold medalist himself, Thomas Bach. Lord Sebastian Coe, another former Olympic gold medalist, an IOC member from Great Britain, the president of the International Association of Athletics Federations.
Médaille d'argent, representant l'Ethiopie. Silver medalist, representing Ethiopia. Medalha de prata, representando a Ethiopia.
And representing Faisa Ethiopia. It's Faisa Lilesa, a very emotional performance as he crossed the line. Let's just hope his medal can spread the Olympic message of peace to his troubled land. Ran in a time of 2:09.54.
And after all that distance, the distance separating silver and gold was 1 minute and 10 seconds. And after winning Olympic medals on the track in the 5,000, a bronze in Athens, a silver in Beijing, it was the marathon that finally brings him a gold medal. Eliud Kipchoge of Kenya, 2 hours, 8 minutes, 0.44. Kenya claiming both the men's and women's marathon, with Jemima Jalagat Sumgong winning the women's. We now pause to hear the national anthem of Kenya.
Mesdames et messieurs, l'hymne du Kenya.
Ladies and gentlemen, the anthem of Kenya.
Senhoras e senhores, o hino do Kenya.
the victory.
Mesdames et messieurs, les médaillés olympiques.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Olympic medalists.
In front of 60,000 fans here at American Art. And the athletes of the Olympic Games from all sports watching on this medal presentation ceremony.